Good morning, everyone. If I could ask people to take their seats. Good morning. This meeting of the California High Speed Rail Authority will come to order. And I'd like to ask our secretary to please call the roll to establish a quorum.
Director Schenck.
Here.
Vice Chair Richards.
I guess you are.
I guess I am. That woke me up.
Vice Chair Richards.
Here. Thank you.
Director Rossi. Director Curtin.
Here.
Director Correa. Director Lowenthal.
Here.
Director Paskett. And Chair Richard.
I'm here. Vice Chair Richards, will you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
Please stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I want to welcome everyone this morning and say that how much we appreciate being here in Bakersfield. In the 4.5 years that I've been on the High Speed Rail Authority Board, this is the first time while I've been on the board that we've met in Bakersfield, so it's been many, many years. You gave us a beautiful, lovely morning in your fair city, and I also want to express our thanks to the mayor and the city manager and the city government for allowing us to use your chambers this morning here. We're going to do something a little bit out of order today. Normally we have all public comment come first for any item on the agenda. But there have been a number of questions that have come up, and I think a number of people are here today because of the questions about the various alignment possibilities that are going to be discussed. And we thought that it would be best to allow our staff to make a presentation first so that members of the public can be informed about that prior to standing up and making their comments. We thought that it would help you and help inform the discussion. But before we do that, I'm very pleased to say that we're graced by the presence of the city's leaders, and Mayor Hall is with us this morning and has asked to address us, and it's an honor to have you do that, Mr. Mayor. Thank you very much. Mayor Hall.
Good morning, Chairman Richard, members of the board, Mr. Morales, and staff. I'm Mayor Harvey Hall, and it's my privilege to welcome all of you to the city of Bakersfield. I want to thank you for holding this meeting here today, as this is a great opportunity for those in the southern San Joaquin Valley to interact directly with the High Speed Rail Authority and learn more about the High Speed Rail project. As I am sure you are all aware, the City of Bakersfield has been engaged with your agency since the initiation of the High Speed Rail project many years ago. The City Council and its staff have diligently analyzed the work of the authority over the years to ensure that the city was well informed about the potential changes a project of this magnitude might bring to our community. During that time, our staff has worked to make certain that the city's views regarding this project were clearly articulated and understood by the authority. I know at times this has placed the city in an adversarial position to the High Speed Rail project. But I am pleased that in the more recent times, through positive collaboration, the city and the authority have been able to achieve significant progress on finding a mutually agreeable path forward. Evidence of this collaborative effort can be found in the information provided to support item 3 on today's agenda. By working together, the city and the authority have identified a much more preferable path for the high-speed rail through Bakersfield than what was previously considered. I am happy to see the results of this work in the recommendation before you to include the F Street alternative as the initial staff recommended preferred alternative alignment in the Bakersfield area for inclusion in the forthcoming draft supplemental environmental document. I am hopeful that this spirit of collaboration and cooperation will continue between our two agencies As the environmental process moves forward and ultimately through the realization of high-speed rail service to Bakersfield. For the members of the public here today, I want to remind them, whether you support the high-speed rail project or not, you must realize that it is incumbent upon the city to take the necessary steps to plan for the eventuality of this project, so Bakersfield is positioned to take advantage of this new form of interstate transportation. I look forward to your board's approval of item 3 today, and I thank you for allowing me this time this morning to address you. I hope that all of you have an enjoyable day in Bakersfield, and thanks again for coming to Bakersfield and allowing our community this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Mr. Mayor, thank you, and we had a chance to visit for a few moments this morning, and I reiterated to you, and it's something that I hope becomes clear from our meeting today, that the High Speed Rail Authority is absolutely committed to pushing this project all the way into Bakersfield. We will work with you to figure out the best alignments to do that, but the opportunity to connect this great economic center with other parts of California, I think, is before us, and we're going to continue to work with you on that. So thank you again, sir, for taking time to come and welcome us today and for allowing us to use your chambers here. With that, we will move immediately to item 3, only for the presentation part, and then that will be followed by public comment and the rest of our agenda. We hope that this will be a useful sequence for members of the public. And Mr. Morales, do you want to introduce this item, or how do you want to do this? Or just have Ms. Gomez?
I think Diana can lead in, and as you said, we'll present, have discussion, comment afterwards, and then question and answer after the public comment period.
All right. So Diana Gomez is our regional leader for the Central Valley. She should be known to many of you, and she's been an absolute asset to the project. So Ms. Gomez, good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Chairman and board members. So what we're going to do, do a presentation. There'll be three speakers during the presentation, myself, our Director of Environmental Services, Mark McLaughlin, and also the City Manager of City of Bakersfield, Alan Tandy. So in, as we all recall, in the Fresno to Bakersfield project section, which was a 114-mile corridor, we approved, we certified in summer of 2014 the final environmental document. In that document, there was a preferred alternatives that were included in parts of the BNSF alternative. It had the Corcoran bypass, Allensworth bypass alternative, the Bakersfield hybrid alternative, and three station location, one in Fresno, King's Tulare, and one in Bakersfield. At the time, the board approved, certified all of the preferred alignments except for in the city of Bakersfield, although the FRA did approve the entire document. As part of our, after we certified the document, there was several lawsuits, legal challenges, and the city of Bakersfield was one of those who challenged the document. So several months afterwards, the authority signed the settlement agreement with the city of Bakersfield. And what it did, it identified a proposed conceptual new alignment and station location. It allowed for us to coordinate between both the city and the authority to refine a locally generated alternative. It also outlined engagement with public and affected stakeholders. It also provided the environmental impacts of a new alignment to be evaluated into a supplemental draft document, which we intend to do later in 2016, but also compare that with the current approved alignment, which was a hybrid alignment, and the Truxton station. So the locally generated alignment that was conceived by both the authority and the city and several stakeholders, it's a 23-mile corridor. The station is at F Street, and Golden State Avenue. The northern terminus of the LGA starts at Poplar Avenue in the city of Shafter and continues southeast, coinciding with the May 2014 project until it splits and proceeds along Burbank Street. As it approaches State Route 99, the LGA begins to turn southeast and continues through the city of Bakersfield. The proposed F Street station would be located just east of the Kern River. The station site is bounded by the Kern River to the west, the UPRR to the north, Chester Avenue to the east, and State Route 204 to the south. Beyond the station, the alignment would continue southeast until the south terminus of the section at Oswell Street, which was part of the previous document. The May 14 project also began at Poplar Avenue and Shafter and continued southeast, southeast adjacent to the State Route 43 and BNSF. So that would be the hybrid alignment. It approaches Brimhill Road, it begins to turn east, and it continues east through the city of Bakersfield. The Truxton Avenue station would be bounded by U Street to the west, Truxton Avenue to the north, Sonora Street to the east, and Hayden Court to the south. The hybrid alignment would continue east until Oswell, which is where they both meet. What we're requesting today is it's based on a new federal law. What we're requesting the board is based on a Map 21 and the implementing guidances. The new federal law was passed in 2012, and it applies to federal transportation agencies such as the Federal Railroad Administration, which is our federal partner. The new law is known as Map 21. Map 21 creates a new requirement for federal environmental lead agencies that, to the maximum extent practicable, combines the federal environmental impact statement and the record of decision into a single document. The Department of Transportation, FRA's parent agency, has issued guidance to this effect, which can be found in one of the websites. I won't go into too much detail. Traditionally, and prior to Map 21, the environmental document or impact statement and the ROD were two separate documents separated in time. The environmental impact statement being issued and available for public review at least 30 days prior to the ROD issuance. In that traditional arrangement, identification of a preferred alternative for the first time was in the impact statement, which allowed the public some time prior to agency decision via the ROD to acknowledge what the agency is identifying as a preferred choice and expresses their views on the preference and its potential environmental impacts. The request that we're asking is the previously preferred alternative was not identified, like I mentioned, until the final. The request is consistent with CEQA, which requires draft EIRs to identify its proposed project. Under Map 21, however, identification of a preferred alternative for the first time in the environmental statement that would also be the ROD would provide the public no opportunity to comment prior to decision. Accordingly, federal agencies have been moving towards identifying the preferred alternative in the draft to ensure that the public can review and comment on the preferred alternative and its potential impacts prior to an agency's final decision via combined of the environmental statement and the ROD. FRA sister agencies, FHWA and FTA, issued guidance, which the DOT endorsed as appropriate, in which they strongly recommend that the preferred alternative be identified in the draft document in order to facilitate issuing a combined environmental statement and ROD document. This approach is consistent with Map 21, withstanding NEPA regulations that authorize identifications of a preferred alternative in a draft. Based on Map 21, FRA has indicated to the authority its intent to issue a combined document for future alignment decisions in the statewide high-speed rail system. including decisions about an alignment through Bakersfield. To facilitate, the FRA intends to identify its preferred alternative in future draft environmental documents, including forthcoming draft supplemental Fresno to Bakersfield that will focus on the Bakersfield alignments, which is why we're here today. So identification of a preferred alternative is not an approval or even an tentative approval of that alternative. It is a preliminary identification of an alternative that the agencies believe at that point in time would best meet purpose and need and project objectives, pending the analysis and public comment to be received in the draft document and the final document, and concurrence by other regulatory agencies such as the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. For the past months, we have been working with the City of Bakersfield and the City of Shafter to refine the locally generated alternative. At this time, Alan Tandy will talk about how it impacts the City of Bakersfield.
Thank you. Mr. Tandy, good morning. Welcome.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Board. Again, as the Mayor welcomed you, I also extend welcome and hope you return. I would like to start by expressing thanks to Jeff Morales, Diana Gomez, the other members of the High Speed Rail Authority staff who've been working very cooperatively with the city the last number of months. It is much nicer to be in a position of cooperation and exchange of ideas and possible solutions than in court, and we hope to continue the new and enhanced relationship. The city and the High Speed Rail Authority have had at least two public workshops and well over 20 meetings with potentially impacted parties locally to consider impacts of the locally generated alternative to them. I am pleased to report that your staff and the authority worked cooperatively and problem solved, tried to accommodate the wishes of those constituents wherever possible, and that most of those meetings ended in a positive manner. The locally generated alternative is shorter, straighter, lower, faster, and less costly than the hybrid. It impacts fewer residents and businesses. It is buffered on one side by an existing rail line. Most importantly, it does not negatively take out the city corporation yard, which is the point from which we provide all of our field services in the city, all parking for our arena and convention center, and our police maintenance garage, and it does not negatively impact key elements of our community tax base, including World Oil and Dignity Health. Map 21 and the use of a preferred alternative may be new to the High Speed Rail Authority. It is not new in the city of Bakersfield. A freeway project that we have worked on with Caltrans for the last 10 years utilized this tool this last year, and the process has gone well and successfully. On behalf of the City Council and the constituents they represent, we encourage you to support the high-speed rail staff recommendation. And again, thank you for working with the ninth largest city in California.
Thank you, Mr. Tandy. And may I also say that I appreciate those kind words about our staff, but I think the phrase is it takes two to tango. So I think we would also thank you and the city leadership for working with us. I know things started off in a contentious way, but we just chalk that up to people trying to protect their communities, and fortunately, I think are moving in a positive direction here. So thank you, sir. Ms. Gomez.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about the outreach that we have been doing, and then we'll have Mark talk the technical details of the studies so far. So as we mentioned, the potential benefits, it is a shorter alignment in miles and travel times. It does have potentially fewer impacts to home, businesses, and schools. It's more cost efficient. The F Street station would revitalize station location and area around the station. These are the preliminary assessments and the detailed analysis informed by the forthcoming environmental document is still will still be developed. As mentioned earlier, as of April 26, we have conducted over 54 stakeholder meetings, 10 technical working group meetings. We've met with an activity center. We've had three community open houses. We have met with numerous of the businesses, including Bedard Brothers, Seiko Ranch, the Mercado Latino, Sumner Street Businesses, Rain for Rent, Bakersfield Homeless Shelter, and Halliburton, and others too that we did not mention. And in every case, when we have met with them, we have taken their concerns and modified or made adjustments to the locally generated alignment to minimize those impacts. I do want to state that the city of Bakersfield has participated in all of those meetings with us, specifically when we go out and do the community events. We've also met with the school districts potentially impacted by the locally generated alignment and the hybrid Bakersfield City School District, Fairfax School District, Beardsley School District, and Kern High School District. So a lot of activity has been done around community engagement, and we will continue to do community engagement as the draft is being developed and once it is released. Now we're gonna have Mark, Director of Environmental Services, talk about some of the technical information that that we have discovered so far.
Okay. Mr. McLaughlin, good morning.
Excuse me, good morning, Chairman, members of the board. Mark McLaughlin, the Director of Environmental Services for the authority. So part of what we do, and I'll get maybe into, I'll try not to get too into the weeds, but there are important things that I'll talk about today as it relates to different technical parts of the project. So the staff has already taken a look at the potential evaluation and impacts of the project and have some preliminary analysis also. So we look at primarily the resources, environmental resources, habitat, wetlands, waters, but we also look at community issues. We also look at ways to set up these technical reports that will be done in the eventual environmental document, the EIS, EIR. And currently we're preliminarily finding that the LG has a little less impact than the hybrid on many items, including the protected waters, which is important in the 404B1 analysis we get as we move forward in with the Corps and the EPA. Also less cost and less travel time, which is important to the project.
You should just clarify, 404 is Section 404, federal law.
Clean Water Act, yes.
Clean Water Act, that's the Corps of Engineers purview.
Correct.
Over the project.
Correct, and we currently have an integration MOU with the Corps and also the US EPA. Excuse me. So part of it, we also take a look at, there's a lot of merits in these four items that we'll talk about. There's Section 4F, aquatic habitats, agricultural lands, and then also residential displacements. So in the LGA in the May of 2014 and the May 2014 project are similar to each other in terms of that engineering focus, maintenance, and the environmental impacts. The impacts associated with transportation, air quality, and public utilities, energy, geology, and soils, safety and security, and cultural resources are very similar between the two alternatives. However, these resource topics demonstrate the merits of the LGA moving forward. So this information presented in the preliminary is preliminary and will continue to be refined as we release and the draft EIR, EIS, and move into that 404B1 process. So one of the items, and I'll go into a little bit more detail here, is Section 4F. Any federally funded transportation project is required to evaluate impacts to Section 4F properties. These are historic properties, public accessible recreational facilities are considered 4F uses if there's impacts to those properties. If an alternative impacts a Section 4F use, it must be demonstrated that all efforts to avoid this impact are properly have been considered in the process. In the May 2014 project, the FRA concluded that impacts to the Kern River Parkway and Mill Creek Linear Park were de minimis. However, the City of Bakersfield, as a responsible agency for these recreational facilities, did not submit a letter of concurrence agreeing to these findings of de minimis. But it's also important to know and distinguish, however, that the City has indicated that under the LGA, that the City has currently verbally agreed with the de minimis finding associated with impacts to that Kern River Parkway and also Wheel Park. In the absence of the city's concurrence under the May 2014 project, the city's support under the LGA further demonstrates the merits of this alternative. So on aquatic habitats, which is important, as you referenced in the 404B1 section of the Clean Water Act, that waters are very important, whether they're quality of waters, waters of the U.S., vernal pools, and other types of wetlands are important in the analysis of that B1 analysis. And currently, the LGA is apparent as the preliminary LEDPA, which is the least environmentally damaging practical alternative. So that's the primary, the way that the Corps and EPA looks at it, in addition to other factors. We also have fewer direct impacts to waters of the U.S. In the hybrid, and the distinction there is quality and quantity. It's a very important distinction there. To go further, we also took a look at the evaluation from the May 2014 project and the LGA. We evaluated the wetland impacts, assessed the quality of the habitat based upon the relative conditions of the wetland features. So wetland features are categorized either as excellent, good, fair, or poor, depending on the relative condition of the wetland and or waters. If a wetland feature scores high, it is considered an excellent quality water, such as vernal pools are probably the highest quality waters that we have in California right now in this region. Good quality waters, which consist of seasonal riverine and vernal pool habitats, are of lesser quality. Fair quality features include ditches and seasonal wetlands. Also, if a wetland feature scores low, poor quality, such as a canal or a detention basin, that's kind of the ranking as we go from high to low. For the May 2014 project, good quality waters are associated with the Kern River Parkway crossing. The May 2014 would directly 2.26 acres of good quality waters. For the LGA, there is no good quality waters are located with the impact of the footprint, and therefore the LGA would not result in impacts to those good quality waters. It's an important distinction. So also on the community impacts, it's important to note also the methodology we used in these impacts and businesses are generally conservative. If we touch a parcel or impact by the project, we consider that an impact. The actual impacts may ultimately be less when the project actually gets built and we refine where that actual footprint will be. So as you can see, the important pieces that the LGA has 17 on the residential and 148 on the 2014. So stark differences as we go down the line for that. Also important, very important resource here that we acknowledge in the Central Valley is the agricultural lands in which we're going to operate. The LGA would cause nearly $1.35 million less of ag business revenue than the previous May 2014. And we would also have less impacts to important farmland and lands under Williamson contract. So these maps show also the comparison in the ag lands. On the left, we have the May 2014, and the dark green is prime farmland for both alternatives. The 2014 project would result in the conversion of 906 acres of important farmland. The LGA alternative result in the conversion of 655 acres. Also, the dark green indicates parcels that are under Williamson Act, an important thing to note under Williamson Act of the importance of these lands. 2014 would permanently impact 601 acres of land, and the LGA alternative would be 252. So quite a reduction.
I'm sorry, but can you just go back to that? I just want to make sure members of the public can understand this chart. And maybe they do, but I don't quite. So I'm looking at the screen here, on the left, there's more areas of dark green, and they don't occur on the one on the right. So can you just talk about the significance of the colors there for a second?
Good point. I'm not sure if that's a different, if one of the maps has to do with Williamson Act and then also important farmland. I can't see the detail there, Mr. Chair.
Oh, it's down in the
corner. On that left-hand table there. What does it say? Is it important and concept? Right, yeah.
Okay, so it looks like the dark green on the left, as Mr. Morales was telling me, is prime farmland. And then the map on the right is Williamson Act contract lands.
Correct.
And so you again, see the darkest green are prime ag lands, and the lighter colors are gradations down from that.
Right. The red line is the existing hybrid, and the purple is the LGA.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. So this is another important topic on the project on environmental justice. So we have to note that environmental justice is a requirement by an executive order and a federal requirement. And environmental justice is also a state policy. For the document, an environmental justice community is one that contains 50% or more minority persons and or 25% or more low-income persons, or the percentage of the minority and or low-income persons is more than 10 percentage points greater than the average of the surrounding area. A minority is a self-identifying non-white person. Communities are defined at the census block level. 90% of the study area, to note, is within an environmental justice community. Both of the existing alternatives have disproportionate adverse effects on environmental justice communities. The noise impacts would be more intense for the LGA than the 2014 project, and the LGA would have less and intense adverse effects from community division and land use, to note, and park impacts. We also know that our policy is not just applicable to the environmental document, it's also applicable to everything that the authority engages in term programs, policies, and our activities. So here's a map of the census data of overlay of the 2014 project and the LGA, and it's based on population density. There's another tool called CalEnviroScreen that's also used, but this only tracks health impacts to communities. We'll utilize this data in addition to the environmental data from the census tract to combine those. So to summarize from our preliminary analysis, that both of them, the LGA and the 2014 hybrid, are similar in engineering, maintenance, and environmental impacts. But we also have to do full analysis of the merits of that LGA, including the community support and engagement, the impacts, fewer impacts to aquatic habitats, less displacement of residential dwellings, and significantly fewer impacts to the important farmland and Williamson Act. For the project also operationally, we have a higher design speed, shorter trip time, and lower anticipated costs, which is important in the overall focus of the program. So the next steps that we have today is also board concurrence to identify the LGA as the preferred alternative in the draft, EIR-EIS, and also we, pending approval of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and the EPA, U.S. EPA, in our checkpoint 404B1 analysis. As Diana mentioned, there'll be continued engagement with community stakeholders, with the city and the counties, and also the communities in which we operate, specifically those environmental justice communities. We will circulate the draft supplemental EIR-EIS, have a public review, an agency review about 45 days, and we'll respond to those comments in the final SEIR-SEIS supplemental. We'll compare the LGA and the hybrid, and then a decision to get to what the eventual preferred alternative will be. But it's no way at this point in time a final until we go through those steps. So what we're requesting today is to identify the LGA as a preliminary preferred, and then we will move on to request concurrence from the Corps and the EPA that the LGA is the tentative least environmentally damaging practical alternative as defined by the Clean Water Act. Also, after that concurrence, if we are successful in that, LGA will be identified in the draft supplemental EIR-EIS as the preferred. That completes the presentation.
Okay. I think we want to hear from the public, but I wanted to raise one or two questions that I hope will help the public in understanding this and in discourse with the board. And so I'll direct them to... I may direct some of them to our general counsel, Mr. Flens, to try to understand this. So we've obviously seen correspondence from people on both sides of this question. And so I think that there is some concern about the use of the term preferred alternative. So as I understand it, that's a legal term of art, if you will, that is contained in the various federal and state laws.
Yes, it is. Yes.
Turn your mic correct. On. Okay.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. And then just my second question is that so basically at this point, in terms of designating one of the alignments, in this case the locally generated alignment, as the preferred alternative, which is what we're being asked to do, in terms of designating an alignment as preferred, this is something that the new federal MAP 21 law requires, encourages, or allows. What's the right verb there?
It encourages, and the FRA,
Federal Railroad Administration,
has indicated that that's what the direction that they want to go with, which is to they identify the preferred, and they've communicated that to us, and that their intent is with the supplemental EIR-EIS for this extension into Bakersfield, that that's what they will be using in the EIS process because they're the lead agency there.
Okay, so then my understanding then is that the federal law, the statute, MAP 21, encourages this. The implementing agency, the FRA, has issued guidance that further encourages and promotes this notion of picking a preferred alternative at this stage in the process.
Yes, the Federal Highway Administration and FTA as well have put the guidance out, and that FRA has, Federal Railroad Administration, has decided to follow that for our project.
And then my last question on this, and again, I don't want to hold off public comment, I just want to try to be helpful with it, is for people who want to support a different alignment, are they prejudiced at this point by this designation if that is the action the board takes?
No. This is not a decision by the board, and that this is just an early opportunity for staff to share with the board and ask their concurrence that the information, as Mark and Diane have presented to so far, indicates that
this is
the preferred under the standards that are used that Mark laid out.
All right. I know there's been a lot of concern about that expressed in parts of the community, and I want to make sure that we're clear on that. Ms. Shank, did you want to add something?
Yes, and again, we don't want to delay public comment, but I too have heard the same concerns, and there is certainly a basis for misunderstanding here. So while we're hearing from the public, if council could draft an additional whereas in our resolution that explains this a little more thoroughly, because it's sort of conclusionary in the ultimate resolution.
Sure, we'll be happy to do that.
Okay. Other questions? Vice Chair Richards at this point?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a quick question, Tom. We've heard it referred to as preferred and preliminary preferred. I think that the language you've used is preliminarily preferred.
Yes.
So what is the implications of the difference between preliminarily preferred and preferred at this point?
In the draft, the EIR will designate it as the preferred. And that draft should come out, I think, the end of the summer. So this is kind of an earlier view of that for the public to then be able to focus on what appears to be, based on the information provided by staff, the direction toward the inclusion of a preferred in the draft EIR.
Okay, subject to our later action.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions at this point? Mr. Curtin.
Not really a question. The terminology I'd like to focus on is the locally generated alternative, and hopefully whatever alternative we end up will continue to have those initials, the locally generated alternative, when it's finally preferred.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to turn to public comment now. I'd like to make it clear to the public that we take our obligations under the open meeting laws very seriously, and the fact that I was trying to help clarify or frame the issues for you in no way is meant to discourage people from expressing whatever views they have to express to us today. So not that as we sit here in Bakersfield, I think people will be shy about that, but I just thought that I would, I thought I would make that point. So it is our practice to take comments in the order in which they're received, but also to accord, afford our public elected officials an opportunity to speak first. And just one small thing. I noticed some people are filming the proceedings with smartphones, and that's certainly your right, but is it not correct? These will all be available on the website. The entire proceedings are videotaped, so I just was getting nervous that somebody was going to lose feeling in their arms by holding up their camera. But you're welcome to do that, and yeah, you don't want Verizon or whoever hitting you with data charges. So anyway, our proceedings are fully fully videotaped and available on our website for High Speed Rail. So I will take comments in order. I see some people still have green cards. If you could provide them to Ms. Alley, who is there. And we'll start. So we have an incursion from the north. Mayor Ashley Swearingen from the city of Fresno has traveled to Bakersfield this morning. Madam Mayor, always great to see you.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Chair and members of the authority. It is great to be with you here today in our sister city down the 99 in Bakersfield. I'm here representing Fresno Works, which is a coalition of about two dozen public and private partners who gathered in 2009 to support the Fresno location for the heavy maintenance facility. I'm joined by my colleague from the Fresno City Council, Oliver Baines, representatives from the Fresno Council of Government, the Fresno Chamber of Commerce, private sector partners, the Fresno State College of Engineering, State Center Community College District, as well as the Economic Development Corporation serving Fresno County. I want to just make 3 points here this morning, and then I'll step aside and let you get on to other comments from the public and your business. Number one, I want to reinforce the longstanding support for high-speed rail that you've received from the city of Fresno and from Fresno Works. I recall before being elected mayor, there were a group of civic leaders, public and private, in the Fresno area who petitioned then-Governor Schwarzenegger to support the project and to move forward with construction beginning in the central San Joaquin Valley. That led to 2008, with Fresno County being very active in helping to pass the bond measure in the first place. And then in 2009, Fresno Works was formed to help make sure that our area is given every consideration for the heavy maintenance facility. The second thing I wanted to reinforce with you this morning are the ways in which the city of Fresno specifically, as one of the partners on the ground in the Fresno region supporting high-speed rail, has worked very actively to facilitate, encourage, anticipate your needs, and ultimately leverage the investment of high-speed rail to the benefit of our residents and the greater Fresno area. Those efforts over the last 7 years include the following. First of all, we've developed and environmentally cleared a 2035 general plan, which reduces greenhouse gases in the Fresno area by 40% compared to status quo development, and takes into consideration high-speed rail and really centers our entire land use plan around what will happen in the middle of our city and downtown as a result of high-speed rail. We've rewritten a 60-year-old development code to anticipate the need for mixed-use and transit-oriented development. That was approved by our city council earlier this year. And then we took the aggressive and comprehensive step to rezone our entire city on February 4th, and rezoning the city created mixed-use zone districts and transit-oriented development down the spine of our city and in the heart of our city, which, of course, is the location of the station area. We have also prioritized, planned, funded, environmentally cleared, gotten through the lawsuits, and now construction has begun on the Fulton Street reconstruction project, which is the front door for the Fresno High-Speed Rail Station. It has been an incredible effort to get to this point. If we had not moved that project forward, I dare say that there would not be hope for a successful station area in downtown Fresno. We'll cut the ribbon on that project in early next year. And then next month, we'll break ground on Bus Rapid Transit, which is our local transit accelerated fixed route service to support high-speed rail. And then lastly, we will environmentally clear our Fulton Corridor specific plan this summer, which includes all of the aspects of our station area planning. So in short, In anticipating the investment of high-speed rail, we have completely accommodated through land use planning and our own transportation and infrastructure planning all the ways in which we can support this investment and make sure we leverage it to really create the value that we want to see for the residents of Fresno. Thirdly, and lastly, I just want to reinforce our support for the heavy maintenance facility in Fresno. We believe that we are putting forward the most competitive and the most viable alternative. Obviously, that is subject to debate, and many others will contest that later today in public comment. But let me again go on the record urging the City of Fresno's complete support for the efforts of the Fresno Works Coalition. Thank you, Mr. Chair, and best of luck with your proceedings today.
Thank you, Mayor. You'll be happy to know that Leanne Eager was sitting at the bar last night making sure that we weren't spirited away by people in Bakersfield.
She's doing her job well.
Yes. I don't know how I know that. I must have just read a report somewhere. Councilmember Oliver Baines from Fresno Works. Good morning, Councilmember.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members of the board, and a special good morning to my friend, Vice Chairman Richard. So thank you for having us this morning. I always hate to follow our mayor. She always makes such a compelling argument, and after she speaks, I'm not sure how to follow up and what to say. But I'll simply say this, because I know there's quite a bit of public comment you all want to get to. What the mayor described to you, and I'm going to focus in the heavy maintenance facility, which is so very important to us. What our mayor described to you that Fresno has been doing is preparing. I like to think of our role in this as being visionaries right along with you. The vision for high-speed rail came a couple of decades ago, and if you think back and as we come forward, a lot has happened to prepare, and it took a tremendous vision, tremendous leaps forward to get to this point. Well, funny enough, we've been doing the very same thing, almost on a parallel track. We have had that very same vision. We have prepared our city, as you heard, in many ways. We have prepared our community. The City of Fresno has been a stalwart supporter along the way with you, as you heard from our highest elected official and several members of the Fresno City Council as well. We have come alongside that vision and realized what the promise and the future of high-speed rail is. We are the visionary city right along with you. So as you contemplate where to locate a heavy maintenance facility and all the surrounding assets that come with it, please remember your visionary partners along the way in Fresno. We have been right there with you. We see the vision. We understand the vision. We know that this is going to change the complexity of the United States of America, and we are proud that this project is starting right in the Central Valley, right in the heart of Fresno. So thank you. We appreciate your time and effort. We appreciate the heavy lift that you all do as board members. You all are on the right side of history in this effort, and we want to be right there with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Council Member. Ram Nuna from Fresno State. And I should say, he'll be followed by Rob Terry.
Good morning. My name is Ram Nina. I'm Dean of the Lyles College of Engineering at Fresno State. California State University Fresno is a partner of the Fresno Works team. We've remained committed to participating in the education subcommittee. Along with our other education partners, we're in the process of researching the required undergraduate and graduate programs that will have an emphasis in high-speed rail management. Currently, Fresno State is one of the largest campuses of the CSU system with more than 23,000 students. This year, 1,700 of them pursued engineering programs and construction management programs at Fresno State. The colleges within Fresno State of particular interest to the High Speed Rail Authority would include the Craig School of Business, the College of Science and Math, our Department of Industrial Technology, and of course, the Lyles College of Engineering. Graduation is coming up in 2 weeks, and many of our graduating seniors are leaving the region to seek high-paying jobs elsewhere. Securing the high maintenance facility will reduce Fresno's brain drain of our young college graduates, providing them more desirable job opportunities, especially in manufacturing, energy, logistics, and even more. As Dean of the College of Engineering, I stand before you today to let you know that Fresno State is here to reaffirm a commitment to the Fresno Works heavy maintenance proposal and to reassure you that we, as a university, are moving forward with the development of educational programs that will position Fresno County as the best viable site for the heavy maintenance facility for the state. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor. Rob Terry, Fresno Cog, followed by Nathan Ale, I think it is. Is that pretty good?
Thank you, Chairman, members of the board. My name is Rob Terry with the Fresno Council of Governments. I appreciate the opportunity to speak before you today and thank the City of Bakersfield for hosting this meeting. I stand before you today as a representative of the Fresno COG, as the Regional Transportation Planning Agency for the Fresno region. We are a collection of the 16, the Fresno County, the 15 incorporated cities. We have been an active and engaged member of the Fresno Works Group since its inception. In 2010, the board passed a resolution of support for the heavy maintenance facility and for COG's involvement seeking that. That has been an active and an ongoing, still consistent commitment to seeking this site since that time. I would like to point out that we have extremely viable funding for the area. Out of Measure CR self-help tax, we have as a region committed $25 million to the placement of the heavy maintenance facility site in Fresno. That is something that we continually would like to point to and want to point out that that shows, really puts our money where our mouth is to show our commitment to this site and to bringing the heavy maintenance facility to the Fresno area. The site's proposed site has excellent access to State Routes 99 and State Routes 41, making it terrific with highly functioning road infrastructure that is already in place. And it continues to be an active and engaged corridor and continues to be a very active partnership amongst all of the member agencies of the Fresno Council of Governments. So I stand before you to continually express our support for the heavy maintenance facility siting in Fresno, and I thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you, sir. Is it Mr. Ale? Did I mispronounce it? Ali. Mr. Ali, I'm sorry.
Oh, no worries.
You'll be followed by Dan Souza.
Good morning, Chairman Richard, members of the board. It's great to be here. Great to be back in Bakersfield. My name is Nathan Ali. I'm the president and CEO of the Fresno Chamber of Commerce. We represent nearly 1,200 members and over 75,000 employees in the greater Fresno area. And we are happy to share our support for the heavy maintenance facility in Fresno. We have long been a key player in Fresno Works' efforts to develop the HMF in Fresno County. This oriented in that plan, we have identified an area that we developed as an industrial park that's adjacent to the HMF. This park will offer financial incentives, including enterprise, foreign trade and hub zones, global and national marketing through the Fresno EDC, and technical assistance and help with the fast track and permitting process, substantially expediting any HSR-oriented projects. We anticipate this HMF will draw a steady stream of visitors that will want to learn more about high-speed rail and rolling stock and or to market their equipment and technology. Fresno County is the ideal site for this HMF, given that it houses premier medical facilities that are equipped to address the healthcare needs of the influx of tourists and new employees in the Fresno area due to high-speed rail. For example, Community Regional Medical Center is one of our members at the Chamber of Commerce and is one of the largest providers of healthcare services in the Central Valley. It is the only burn and level one trauma center between Los Angeles and Sacramento. Fresno County also has a strong emergency response service plan in place that has been coordinated through a public-private partnership to be able to address possible critical life-saving situations. In short, the Fresno Chamber's mission is to support and promote the success of the regional business community through effective advocacy, education, and relationship building. This has been exemplified through our work in the planning and development of the HMF in Fresno County, and we look forward to continuing to work with the authority and everyone involved to meet the needs of the business community as we expand high-speed rail development in the Fresno area. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Alley. Dan Souza, followed by Martin Dietz.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and the board. My name's Dan Souza. I'm a CTE coordinator and apprenticeship coordinator representing State Center Community College District. And today, I'm here to represent State Center Community College District and say that we are a proud participant of the Fresno Works Heavy Maintenance Facility. Fresno County maintains the region's largest combination of higher education and CTE training facilities. Students are pursuing higher education and training every year across almost a dozen public and private university and college community college campuses. The technical training needed for the heavy maintenance facility can easily be met in the Fresno area. Such programs as maintenance mechanic, industrial mechanic, welding programs, and strong electrical programs to serve our region and our community in these job prospects. The State Center Community College District has three college campuses and one center within the Fresno County region, or within Fresno County. Currently, there are over 62,000 students enrolled in the three campuses in the center alone. We have commenced early registration for the upcoming fall semester and expect our student population to continue to grow. State Center offers art and science degree programs and over 60 CTE programs within those campuses. S State Center has received state and national recognition as a model CTE educational institution in community partnerships, competency-based education, and job placement, including pre-apprenticeship and apprenticeship programs. As a representative for State Center Community College District, I stand before you today to let you know that our educational institution's commitment to the support of the Fresno County proposal for the heavy maintenance facility remains strong, and we are diligently working with other local educational institutions to establish the training and support that is necessary to prepare the future workforce for the high-speed rail system, and more importantly, for the heavy maintenance facility's future employment opportunities. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Martin Dietz, followed by Leanne Eager.
Good morning, members of the board, Chairman Richard, and staff. My name is Marty Dietz. I'm an architect. I'm president of Darden Architects. I'm also president of the Fresno Clovis Convention and Visitor Center Bureau, the 501c3 board. I'm a 37-year resident of Fresno, and I'm interested in strengthening the Fresno Clovis local economy and marketing the Fresno Clovis region as a destination for expanding business in many forms, including everything from manufacturing to tourism. Out of 29 counties in California, based on the Visit California's 2016 Outlook Forum, Fresno County is now number 5 in visitor spending. We are pleased with the growth of our community. Increasing spending in Fresno County is resulting in positive economic activity, and it's a win-win for all. I'm also a member of the Fresno Works Group, who's interested in promoting the city of Fresno as the best location for the heavy maintenance center. It's the right choice because of the flexible 700-acre site, conforming to California high-speed rail criteria, no environmental obstacles, it's adjacent to the BNSF alignment, Fresno has the deepest labor pool, and the Central Valley's most extensive support infrastructure, including those you've heard about, airport, college and universities, and emergency services. Thank you for your time this morning.
Thank you, Mr. Dietz. Leanne Eager, followed by Ed Dunkel. Morning.
Good morning. Thank you for outing me that I was at the bar. I'm Leanne Eager, President and CEO of Fresno County Economic Development Corporation. The reason that we brought this illustrious group with us today is, as the mayor said, this group got together in 2009. These are the same members that were there in 2009 working on putting together a proposal for the maintenance facility, but it's also the same group that gets together every month, sometimes every day, working on this project. So this group from Fresno has been supportive of making sure the maintenance facility comes to Fresno County, but also making sure that the high-speed rail comes through the city of Fresno. I just got back on Thursday from a trip to Germany. I was at the Hanover Messe show with the President of the United States. And then I went to Berlin, and Siemens allowed me to take a tour of some of the stations in Berlin and also a heavy maintenance facility. I think I told Jeff I'm going for the World Book of Records for visiting maintenance facilities. this was my number 6 from around the world. So one of the things that we, of course, do is make sure that we're prepared, that we have an education committee, we have a training committee, we have a safety committee, making sure that what we're doing in Fresno County is what needs to be done in order to get our system going, in order to make sure that we're prepared for this. But I do want to congratulate my friends here from the Central Valley. For those of you in Kern County and Bakersfield, congratulations on the work that you've done to get you to this place. I know it isn't easy. I want to congratulate my friends from Madera. They got a stop. congratulations, that's great. We're all working towards that same goal. And I think our new view now is in order to get that track, in order to get that train on that track, in order to get the people on that train on that track, that it takes a valley. So we want to, you can use it. It takes a valley. Fresno County is proud to be a part of that valley that's going to be the first high-speed train in the entire country. And so we thank you for your work, and we're going to continue to work hard to assist you with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Eager. Ed Dunkel.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, good morning. If you want to look bad, you always follow Leanne Eager. So thank you very much for that. As president of Precision Civil Engineering, I'm a proper participant of the Fresno Works effort to bring the heavy maintenance facility to Fresno County. I'm also a fifth-generation Fresno County resident. This is an exciting time in our history. And also, we are a very energetic supporter of the Fresno State's program for high-speed rail. Precision Civil Engineering is a multidisciplinary engineering and surveying firm that includes CEQA, NEPA documentation and technical studies and sustainable development. And we've lent our services to the development of the Fresno Works partnership. We believe this displays Fresno County's commitment in supporting the authority in creating a facility that minimizes adverse impacts to the environment and energy independence. We are confident that the heavy maintenance facility will be a global showcase in sustainability, minimizing opportunities for green and maximizing opportunities for green job creation and training, energy efficiency and power generation, as well as natural resource protection. Today we stand here before you as a proud supporter of the high-speed rail and the partnership of Fresno Works. As such, we are strongly committed to such and strongly committed to establishing strong local, state, national and international bonds and partnerships to assist in the transformation of the supporting California speed high rail vision into a reality. We appreciate the opportunity to speak here today, and this is a very exciting project. Again, we've been supporters since 2009 in trying to bring this to our fair county, and there's been a lot of effort, time, blood, sweat, and tears. It's a great project. A lot of us have taken hits, bullets, because we're supporters, but we know what this means to this state and what it means to our county, and we appreciate the opportunity to speak for you today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dunkel. I want to issue a small apology. I had said that we would take elected officials first, but as I started going through the cards, I realized that people are grouped together with their communities of interest, and I thought it was just going to break things up, so I'm just going to go in order. But so next is the city of Wasco, starting with Mayor Cheryl Wegman. Mayor, thank you for your understanding of that, followed by Paul Parrish, who's the city manager. Good morning.
Good morning, Chairman Richard, board members, and Mr. Morales. My name is Cheryl Wegman. I'm the mayor of the city of Wasco. I'm here today to speak about item number 4. The mitigation agreement between the California High Speed Rail Authority and the City of Wasco. For several years, the City of Wasco has been preparing for the impacts the rail system will have on our city. We have been working tirelessly with members of the High Speed Rail Authority in an effort to be collaborative and cooperative with the needs and desires of the High Speed Rail Authority. Item number 4 is one of these efforts. Throughout the past 2.5 years, the city has been diligently examining the impact the proposed route would have on the city, and specifically to the Wasco farm workers' housing. This housing has been in the city of Wasco since the 1940s, and once served as an internment camp during World War II. Now, this community within the city houses over 200 farm worker families, hardworking individuals who provide for their families daily while working in the fields. These individuals live on the edge of our city, having to cross heavily used freight railroad tracks to attend school, go shopping, go to church, and other activities. The daily noise they experience from the freight trains is something we wish no one would have to experience. As the engineers on these trains blast their horns upon entering the city until exiting the city, a distance of 2.5 miles, seemingly 24 hours a day. It was initially suggested that the use of sound walls would be sufficient to mitigate the noise created by the high-speed rail. However, during discussions with high-speed rail representatives, depictions of the visual intrusion the sound barrier would present were not met with positive reactions. Indeed, the depictions solidified the city's desire to do more for these marginalized citizens. A plan was developed to move the farm worker housing to another location within the city that would reintegrate the residents into the city. These plans continue to evolve. However, the nucleus of the plan involves mitigation money from the authority. The success of this project is dependent on numerous approvals and funding sources, including the Affordable Housing and Sustainable Communities Program, low-income housing tax credits, and assistance from HUD and the USDA. Only by working together as a team will this project and mitigation efforts be successful. By continuing to work together, the overall authority plan will be successful. The City of Wasco is dedicated to working with the authority and pledges to continue to do so. I thank you for your consideration of my comments for item number 4 and for your consideration of the cities of Wasco who will be directly affected by the authority's project. Thank you.
Madam Mayor, thank you. Thank you for your leadership on this. We appreciate it. Paul Parrish, City Manager from Wasco. Good morning, sir.
Morning. Morning, Chairman Richard and board members and Mr. Morales. Thank you for the time. My name is J. Paul Parrish, and I'm the City Manager for the City of Wasco. I'm also here today to speak about item number 4, the mitigation agreement between the California High-Speed Rail Authority and the City of Wasco. I understand item 3 is the big one, but we need to interject here. As the mayor mentioned, the City of Wasco has been preparing for the impacts the rail system will have on our city for several years. We have put a number of projects on hold while the authority and the city supportively work together to obtain the best results for both parties. I understand the board may not know all of the impacts that will occur in our city, but I would like to point out some of them, including the relocation of a city well that provides potable water, the creation of undercrossings where the rail would have shut off access to parts of the city, and the relocation construction of our Amtrak station. The processes involved in these discussions were very lengthy. However, they were productive and very fruitful. Most importantly, however, your staff handled these matters professionally and with good leadership. City leadership has been proud to work with HSR staff on these particular issues. Throughout the past 2.5 years, the city has been diligently working with HSR staff in determining the impact of the route to the Wasco farm workers' housing. As mentioned by the mayor, this housing has been in the city since the 1940s and houses over 200 farm worker families. These individuals are the backbone of the agricultural industry and work long hours to provide for their families. Once done with work, these individuals want to come home to enjoy their families, have a good meal, and relax, much like everybody else. However, their homes are literally across the street from the BNSF rail line. This disproportionate noise they experience from the freight trains is something that occurs regularly throughout the day and evening. You can imagine trying to have a conversation with your family when a freight train rumbles by less than 350 to 1,000 feet from your residence, and you understand what they go through on a daily basis. Upon learning the HSR would also be nearby and learning the farm worker housing would experience additional severe noise impacts, city staff began to search for a solution to this issue. The depictions of sound walls to minimize the noise impact created by the HSR, again, as the mayor mentioned, were not well received. However, after discussing the matter with HSR staff and working with our local housing authority, of which representatives are here, the solution to this issue seemed clear. If the High-Speed Rail Authority would identify the city's plan to move the farm worker housing as an appropriate mitigation plan, the city would be able to begin the process of securing the remaining funds necessary to begin the farm worker housing relocation. These funds would be secured from the Affordable Housing and Sustainable Communities Program, low-income housing tax credits, and assistance from HUD and the USDA. Presented to the board today is the beginning of this plan. Item 4, if approved, would allow the city and the HSR to begin the process of mitigating the impacts of the rail system on our most vulnerable citizens, citizens who have been marginalized due to their location on the outskirts of the city limits and due to their separation from the mainstream of the city. City has taken steps to ensure that these citizens are involved in this process and have held town hall meetings in recent months. All who have attended are excited about the possibility of starting over in a new location surrounded by family and friends. Even more exciting to many is the fact a new school will be built across the street, thereby wiping out the need for the children to cross a busy freight line to go to school. One unexpected benefit from this project, the reduction of greenhouse gas, as the students will no longer have to be bused to nearby schools. I thank you for your consideration of my comments to item number 4 and for your consideration of the citizens of Wasco who will be directly affected by the authority's project. The city thanks you as well and will continue to partner with the high-speed rail in its endeavors on this particular project. Again, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I appreciate those comments. Representing the city of Shafter, Scott Hurlburt.
Good morning,
morning.
Chairman Richard, members of the board, and Mr. Morales. I do want to thank you for traveling here to Kern County today to meet locally with folks, and I think there are probably a lot of people here that are hearing some of these issues for the very first time that haven't been able to travel north to see your meetings, and I really do appreciate that. I wrote a few notes. I think I'm going to diverge a little bit from those in deference to some of the comments that have been made in having the presentation beforehand. I think that what is clear in discussing the LGA versus the hybrid is that for the city of Bakersfield, the LGA most likely is a superior alignment. I think what's kind of been left out of some of the discussion is the substantial additional impacts to the city of Shafter north of 7th Standard Road that this alternative alignment creates. And I think that there are going to be impacts no matter what, hybrid or LGA. But I really think it's critical to the integrity of the process that the environmental analysis that's done on the LGA, the entirety of the LGA, from its divergence near the center of Shafter, clear to the F Street station, are studied and analyzed in a way that's equal and transparent to the process that was used for the hybrid alignment. I think that it's clear that it's better for Bakersfield. It's not clear whether or not it's better for Shafter. I suspect there are substantially more impacts than have been identified by these preliminary studies that have been done. And so really that's my request to you today, is to insist that the process be transparent, that the criteria be defined and published ahead of time for how these decisions will be made. And I think the same goes for the heavy maintenance facility. I think one of the things that's also left out of the impacts is that the Shafter site for the heavy maintenance facility, it takes a serious hit in viability with the LGA versus the hybrid. I think it's, the Shafter site is a very competitive site. Free land is tough to get over, and with this this LGA alignment, I think that there are some additional costs introduced here that need to be included in the analysis of the impacts to the landowners, to the communities that are affected. And that's what I wanted to get across today. Again, thank you for coming. I appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mr. Hurlburt. We now have a number of people from Kern County related to the heavy maintenance facility. We'll start with Richard Chapman from the Kern Economic Development Corporation, followed by Lauren Skidmore from Kern for HMF. You brought us reading material, Mr. Chapman.
Yes, and we also have that available online, PDF form. But a little light reading for you. My name is Richard Chapman, the president and CEO of Kern Economic Development Corporation, and thanks for having me here today, Chairman Richard and members of the board. Our organization, Kern EDC, is charged with the economic development strategy, the steward of the economic development strategy for Kern County, and our purpose is to retain and recruit family wage jobs for Kern County. And I've submitted for your consideration our copies of our newly minted 2016 market overview. And what we wanted to do is provide some context to the incredible industrial diversity that Kern County offers future jobs for your project and many others. And wanted to highlight page 12, where we list the top 10 reasons to do business in Kern County. What we like to do is use quantitative rankings from around the country, trusted sources like Brookings, Bureau of Labor Statistics, Bureau of Economic Analysis, and Forbes. By far, the number one site selection for projects like the heavy maintenance facility and the high-speed rail is workforce availability and quality. Regardless, around the country, these type of projects, consultants, site selectors, look for the available workforce and quality workforce. It's that cost competitive edge. We have a saying in economic development, a calf doesn't brand itself. So I can talk about Kern County. We all can talk about our regions, why they're conducive for your projects. But what we like to do, again, is use national trusted groups for these rankings. So for instance, Brookings rated Kern County number 4 for STEM jobs. And these are the sweet spot, we believe, for the high-speed rail. Forbes magazine rated Kern County number 9th for engineering jobs. So again, these are outside folks branding our county. And more importantly, it's that transferability of skills, the underemployed. So with the oil prices at $40 a barrel, we have available workforce and as well as underemployed workforce, that compatibility factor. The Bureau of Labor Statistics, looking at the NAICS code 8113, which is industrial machinery, and occupation codes 47 and 51, which we believe are the majority of the jobs that you have, we have over 100-to-1 ratio of available workers as well as underemployed workers that would fit the needs for heavy high-speed rail. So, in conclusion, we're here today to offer a product, cost-competitive product, strategic location for your future jobs. We urge you to take a closer look, as is our motto, and we do truly believe that Kern County is the best investment a business can make. But again, don't take our words for it. Take the words and the in terms of Brookings, Milken, Bureau of Labor Statistics, and Bureau of Economic Analysis, and others. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Lauren Skidmore, followed by John Spaulding.
Good morning, Chairman Richard and members of the board. First off, welcome to Bakersfield in Kern County. We are thrilled to have you here, and I am personally thrilled to welcome you to a city that I moved back from Fresno for, so thank you.
Wow.
My name is Lauren Skidmore, as I mentioned. I'm representing...
You can't see the pained expressions behind you.
Hey, I did get my degree from there, so I give them a little credit. I am representing Kern for HMF. It is a coalition of local businesses, governments, schools, and leaders supporting the placement of the heavy maintenance facility in Kern County. Other coalition members are here today and have spoken on behalf of their organization, so thank you to them. As mentioned in the staff report for item number 3, prior board action mentions the maintenance of infrastructure facilities in Shafter in your final EIR from Fresno to Bakersfield. We understand that the project is unfolding, and due to very technical components of this project, things change. But we hope all decisions made today and in the future take into account the impacts on our heavy maintenance facility locations in Kern. I've spoken with Diana, and she assures me that the Shafter heavy maintenance facility is still viable with a locally generated alignment. But I do hope to gain clarification that our facilities stay not just viable, but cost-friendly and competitive. We seek criteria for selection of the heavy maintenance facility and other facilities because we do feel that you should place this facility in the best location for high-speed rail. This criteria may also ease some of these great debates that happen at your meetings, and that we hope the criteria is fair and a reflection of the vision of high-speed rail, cost-effective, environmentally friendly, and futuristic. Ironically, the Shafter location is being offered for free. It has no environmental issues and is included in the Kern County Sustainable Community Strategy, ensuring a plan to reducing greenhouse gas. As well, our locations are larger locations than necessary. We have a fabulous labor pool, as described by Richard Chapman, and our educational entities are preparing their students for jobs of the future. So if you want, you can leave this meeting and just begin your project tomorrow. Overall, Kern County is business friendly. We seek industries that will diversify our economy, and we are always interested in providing opportunities to expand jobs in Kern County. We welcome you to support any facilities, and if you want to place all of your facilities in county, we would welcome that as well. But we feel that you and any of your facilities would be a great fit, so thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Skidmore. John Spaulding, followed by Jennifer Patino. Nice to see you again, Mr. Spaulding.
Thank you, Chairman Richards, members of the board, Mr. Morales. I'm John Spaulding, Executive Secretary of the Building and Construction Trades Council. A couple months ago, I spoke in Sacramento about the labor pool that we have available for the construction of high-speed rail, and that hasn't changed. We still have an extensive labor pool, and we have, now that with the downturn in the economy and the oil fields, we have that availability, and those are members that will make good members of ours to become part of the construction workforce. I represent 8,000 building trades and construction members in Kern County along the high-speed rail. Please note that our area has memberships begins at the Kern County line and continues on through Rosemond. Thank you for Section 4, which, although it begins 1 mile north of the Kern County line, has extended 22 miles to the south. We are looking forward to the start of the construction by California Rail Builders, with a local contractor chosen to be his general contractor, Griffith Company. As a member of Kern for HMF, we encourage you to continue to construct and move south in your plans to construct high-speed rail, so that the high-speed rail heavy maintenance facility south of or near 7th Standard Road can be used. 2025 is too far off to wait for the future jobs. That's the date we keep hearing in all the presentations. Up and running by 2025, stopping at Poplar is not popular. We want you to come further south than Poplar Avenue, and we hope funding will become available for that. I also encourage you to enhance the Wasco station, whether it be temporary or not. It will reflect high-speed rail at its very best. It cannot be a loading dock or a bus station. It's an opportunity to share in the high-speed rail facility and the experience. Please come to Kern County, further into Kern County before 2025. That's 9 years away. 2025 is just a date. 9 years is what it is. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Spaulding. Is it Ms. Patino or Patino? Patino?
But
okay, well, I'm just going to leave that where it is.
So. Good morning, Chairman Richard and esteemed members of the board. It's nice to see you again.
Thank you.
I'm Jennifer Patino. I'm the Director of Professional Development Programs at CSU Bakersfield in the Extended University Division. This morning, I thought I'd start with a short story. It's a true story, though. Last week, Dr. Novak, the Dean of Extended University, had to travel to one of our sister schools to do an early morning presentation. It was at San Francisco State, and he decided to go up the day before and leave by 11 a.m. so he could check into his hotel, have an early dinner, and prepare for the next day. His GPS said it would take 3 hours and 56 minutes. 4 hours into the trip, he was still an hour and a half out of San Francisco. 5 hours into the trip, he still had an hour to go. It took him 6.5 hours that day to get to San Francisco. I told that story to highlight exactly our plight here in the Central Valley. Sometimes those that live in larger cities like San Francisco, San Jose, and Sacramento don't understand the difficulties that others face when traveling to their areas. Yes, we know your traffic is terrible and horrible at times, and it can take upwards of 2 hours to get across town. But we in Kern County can't even get to your area in under 6 hours. So how is a person who is trying to provide for their family go to where the jobs are if it takes almost a whole workday to get there? March 2016 labor statistics put Kern County underemployment rates at 11.6%. That's one of the highest in California. But this is where CSU Bakersfield is stepping in. In the last year and a half, CSU Bakersfield provided training and education related to the high-speed rail to tradesmen and women who are underemployed. These trainings were in partnership with the High-Speed Rail Authority and 14 union chapters of the trades in connection with the Fresno and Bakersfield WIB. Additionally, this past March, an international high-speed rail conference and training was held at CSUB. Experts presented from France, Spain, Portugal, and Germany. This was in thanks to our mutual friend, Rod Diridon, who also presented there. Diana was also a presenter. Thank you. Our CSU students were invited to attend for free and had the opportunity to learn with current engineers from all over the world and country just how the high-speed rail has changed other economies, countries, and engineering as a whole. Currently at CSUB, a student working on their engineering degree can get a concentration in high-speed rail. This program, besides being the first and only of its kind, has been very successful. And in June, 10 students from this program will be walking at commencement. The high-speed train simulator we received in March from CSR is almost fully operational. When it is completed, we look forward to providing real-time experience and training to more students, as well as any programming and training we can provide in partnership with you, the California Authority. We are looking to the future and how high-speed rail is going to change the landscape of California. CSUB will be here to educate and train the public in whatever they need. Because CSUB is centrally located, our students will be able to work on the high-speed rail and yet live in an affordable location. In that regard, the prospect of maintenance sites or the heavy maintenance facility coming to Kern County is vital to propel our community forward by providing more opportunities for training, education, and more importantly, employment. As a high-speed rail project develops, CSUB looks forward to providing the necessary education needed by our future high-speed rail workers. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Patino.
Thank you.
Aaron Hakimi, followed by Craig Pope. I hope I pronounced your name correctly, sir.
Yes, you did. Good morning, Mr. Chairman and authority members, and Mr. Morales. My name is Aaron Hakimi. I'm the Executive Director of Kern Council of Governments, Kern County's Transportation Planning Agency. Thank you, Chairman Richard and Commissioners, for coming to Bakersfield. We welcome you to our city and appreciate you taking the time to hold your meeting here. This is an important decision that will have long-lasting effects on our economy and our transportation network. Kern Council of Governments unquestionably supports your staff's recommendation to adopt the F Street alignment. As a licensed civil engineer charged with overseeing the region's planning association for transportation projects in Kern County, I support performance-based designs that minimize impacts, as is clearly the case here. The LGA significantly reduces the number of homes and businesses that the authority will have to acquire to build the Bakersfield station, as well as route high-speed rail through the region. Reducing right-of-way purchases should also allow for a considerably accelerated completion schedule, shaving months, if not years, off your project. Furthermore, this alignment provides for a straighter path and faster speeds than the original alternative, which will only benefit the authority's goal to reduce travel time throughout the state. Today's meeting demonstrates the progress our agencies and organizations can make when we communicate openly about our respective needs, transparently to assure the public is confident in our processes, and often enough to assure that those first two standards are achieved. Thank you again for your time and consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Hakimi. Craig Pope, followed by Dan Levitt.
Good Good morning, Chairman Richards, members of the authority. Craig Pope, Director of Public Works for Kern County. I'm here representing the Board of Supervisors, who unfortunately couldn't be here today because of they're in session right now as we speak. First, I'd like to appreciate you coming to Kern County to bring forward these concerns. We at the county have been working with your staff the whole time through this, and we appreciate the effort they put into it, and I think you're coming up some good solutions here. Kern County has been a partner with rail since it's come to the valley and made it over the Tatchby Mountains. We know rail, we know how to work with rail, and we continue to do so. Also, the county is a partner with heavy industry. We know and understand that. We have the technical expertise, we have the manpower here. We're looking forward to this project being completed through this area. We'd like to thank Jeff Morales for bringing together staff led by Diana Gomez for bringing credibility to the high-speed rail. It has been a pleasure to work with them the last few years on this project. They really have listened, and we've been working with them, and we appreciate that. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Dan Levitt. Then followed by representatives from the City of Madera. Good morning, Mr. Levitt.
Good morning, Chair Richard, members of the board, CEO Morales. Thank you for this opportunity to speak. I'm Dan Levitt, Manager of Regional Initiatives for the San Joaquin Regional Rail Commission. We are the owner-operator of the ACE rail service, which serves from Stockton to San Jose. We're here to support item number 5, and we appreciate staff putting this item on your agenda today. Extending the environmental contract and the engineering contract for the Altamont Corridor project will enable the continued work to increase rail service in the corridor, to expand rail service in the corridor, and to provide improved connectivity to the high-speed rail service. So we appreciate your having this and have our full support on this item. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Levitt. I should have said our next group is from the City and County of Madera, starting with Robert Porthras, the Mayor of the City of Madera. Mr. Mayor, good morning. He'll be followed by Councilmember Charles Rigby.
Good morning and great job in the pronunciation. You get an A. Good morning, Mr. Chair and members of the board. As you mentioned, I'm Robert Poitras, the Mayor of Madera from the heart of California. I'm also here representing the Madera Economic Development Commission, the Madera County Transportation Commission, and the Madera County Workforce Development Board. Before I get started, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for adding a high-speed rail stop in Madera at the Amtrak in your 2016 business plan. It's certainly a game changer for our community, and it's going to be a great thing, and we appreciate it so much. I'm here today also representing why that's WYE in Madera County, a group of community leaders, elected officials, and residents committed to making sure the heavy maintenance facility is located in Madera County. Selecting the location for the heavy maintenance facility is undoubtedly a huge decision, and there's certainly a lot of facets and issues need to be considered. When I think about the enormity of the decision, one thing that really stands out to me is the issue of workforce availability. Madera County is truly in a unique position among other locations being considered because it is centrally located and will ensure the authority has access to a talented workforce via a regional labor pool where other proposed locations do not. As evidence, Madera County is ranked number one in the nation last year for manufacturing job growth. That wouldn't have happened without our workforce availability. Just a few final comments. We do, as I mentioned, have access to the workforce needed to successfully operate the heavy maintenance facility. And we also have planned housing developments to accommodate these new employees so they can live close by. We also have established job training programs oriented toward the skills required for heavy maintenance facility operations, and we can leverage existing partnerships with educational institutions such as Fresno State, State Center Community College District, and UC Merced to develop additional programs if needed. Lastly, as a halfway point between Fresno State and UC Merced, a Madera County site would increase workforce development and other partnership opportunities for for both institutions, as well as the expertise from UC Merced, which hasn't been mentioned yet today. So thank you, Mr. Chair, and members of the board.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councilmember Charles Rigby from Madera, followed by Andy Medean.
Good morning, Chairman Richard and members of the board. I appreciate you allowing us to come and your consideration for the heavy maintenance facility in our county. Again, my name is Charles Rigby. I serve as Mayor Pro Tem for the City of Madera, and I represent the Madera City Council and the County of Madera today. I'm here to express, first of all, my appreciation for the high-speed rail stop at the Madera Amtrak, and as a member of the WYE Madera County, we look forward to that operation, and it's a game-changer, as our mayor already have mentioned. I'd like to also remind you that Madera County is the cheaper, it's faster, and a smarter location for the high-speed rail heavy maintenance facility for a number of reasons. The first and foremost important is that Madera County is a strategic location, as I'm sure you're aware, that it will provide significant cost savings due to increased operational efficiency. As you all know, we are home to the WYE, making Madera County optimal, situated to service trains on both the Sacramento and San Francisco lines more quickly, also efficiently, and cost-effectively than any of the other potential sites. Locating the heavy maintenance facility closer to the Y will reduce the need for additional infrastructure and land acquisition costs during construction. Madera County's central location is accessible. Accessibility will also help reduce operational costs associated with transporting trains to and from the heavy maintenance facility. The City of Madera is also uniquely understands and values partnering with public entities to establish industrial growth and supply manufacturing jobs, as recently recognized by the California Association of Local Economic Development, where we have recently received the Award of Excellence in a category for economic development partnerships. And we look forward to the partnership and our continued work with High Speed Rail Authority. So thank you again for hearing our recommendations, and we look forward to working with you guys in the future.
Thank you, Councilmember. Andy Medean, followed by Norman Allender, I believe it is.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. It's a pleasure to be here this morning, and again, we thank you for your time. And as my colleagues have stated before, I really want to thank you for your decision in having a stop at the Amtrak station in Madera County. This is a huge turning point for Madera County and our future, and again, I want to thank you for that. I also want to say that construction started in Madera County, and we are home to the Y. I also want to state that I truly feel that Madera County is the backbone of the high-speed rail. So again, I'd like to underscore the significant impact you can still have on our county's history by selecting Madera County as a site for the heavy maintenance facility. There are over 1,500 jobs that would be created with just the heavy maintenance facility, and of course, additional jobs provided by ancillary services. We are centrally located, we are operationally efficient, we form numerous community partnerships, we have the workforce and the infrastructure ready to accommodate the facility. But I think the most important thing that I really want to look at here is the impact we would have on our unemployment. You would certainly be able to make that decision to reduce our unemployment from 14% down to a single digit. I think that impact right there has the greatest impact on any other potential location. Madera County would not only benefit our county, but I believe the surrounding counties. With our strategic central location and the connectivity provided by the light rail, the heavy maintenance facility will also benefit workers from other labor markets in the region, including Fresno, Mariposa, Merced, and Modesto. A Madera County site is a regional site and one that will set our county on an exciting new course. I appreciate your time this morning, and we look forward to continuing to working with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Norman Allender, did I get that right?
Yes.
Followed by Charles Follett.
Yes, good morning. Thank you, Chairman, members of the Authority Board. My name is Norman Allender, and I'm here representing Madera County. Supervisors Rodriguez and Frazier send their regrets for not being here, and I serve as the Madera County Planning Director. I'm here with our other Y Madera County friends and partners to express our support for the heavy maintenance facility within our community. Unlike other potential locations, our sites are in common ownership, and we have willing sellers. And considering that we put these packages together when many, over a dozen at that time, of routes existed. So these are routes that have been, or sites that have been vetted in a much different regulatory environment, and they've still held strong in the analysis. Madera County's leadership has united to have the most streamlining permitting process. That's why I think they sent me here today. You're looking at the person who would process this for you, and there's nothing better I like doing than saying yes to a proposal, because with saying no, it feels so bad. So a long-term partnership is important with this. I'd like to echo the previous speaker's comments about having a stop in Madera County. It is something that is appreciated, and we appreciate you for listening to us over the years. And again, as the county planning director and a third-generation resident of Madera County, I can tell you that this will make a big difference. It will move the needle in our community by locating this facility there, and Supervisor Frazier would not be happy with me if I didn't say cheaper, faster, smarter. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Allender. Charles Follett, followed by John Dorman. And he'll be followed by Bill Descari.
Charles Follett from Santa Monica. Good morning, Honorable Chairman Richard and members of the authority. It's a pleasure to be here to speak with you this morning. It is my hope that you are successful in constructing and operating the California bullet train from San Francisco to Los Angeles. The primary difficulty in achieving this is the segment from Bakersfield to Los Angeles. Much has been written regarding the cost and time required to traverse and tunnel through the Tehachapi and San Gabriel Mountains, to the point where many feel that Bakersfield may ultimately be the final southern terminus. To ensure that Los Angeles is, in fact, in play, it's time for the authority to think outside the box. From a geological, geographical, logistical, and financial standpoint, there is an alignment that will enable the completion of the project sooner than expected and under budget. Upon study, you will determine that the most logical alignment to Los Angeles is the following southwest route. Depart Bakersfield to the southwest through Maricopa and Vintucopa to the junction of State Route 33 and Lockwood Valley Road. From here, tunnel under the Los Padres National Forest all the way to the State Route 33 freeway between Ojai and Ventura at Casitas Springs. The tunneling distance will be approximately 17 to 20 miles, compared to a total of 36 miles of tunnels along the Tehachapi route, one measuring 17 miles in length. With lower elevation to deal with than the Tehachapi route, the tunnel and tracks under the Los Padres will have decreased percent grade at 2.5%, allowing the maximum train speeds of 220 miles per hour. Thus, it will take HSR only about 6 minutes to travel under the Los Padres from Lockwood Valley Road to Casitas Springs. Because the train will travel under the forest, it will have no effect on the natural ecosystem above the ground. The tunnels can be bored under a direct line of canyons running north to south, not under summits. This means shallower tunnels that enable construction of escape routes at reasonable depth along its entirety. The biggest difference and advantage of this route is the geology. The Los Padres consist of sedimentary rock. This makeup is much more suitable for boring tunnels. Through the shattered granite and fault zones of the Tehachapi San Gabriels, the boring rate is only 10 to 20 feet per day versus the boring rate of 100 to 200 feet per day through the sedimentary Los Padres. This represents a tenfold reduction in the time to bore the tunnel, not to mention that the southwest route requires half the number of tunnel miles, the result being greatly reduced construction cost and decreased construction time. The fourth advantage of the southwest route is the elimination of the public outcry and opposition being voiced from residents in Sylmar, Lakeview Terrace, and San Fernando. The bullet train alignment from Ventura all the way through Simi Valley, Van Nuys, and Burbank to Union Station will run along an already established right-of-way. Not only will this eliminate the public outcry and litigation, this route will save countless millions by eliminating the need to have subterranean tracks from Santa Clarita to Burbank. Fifth, this route will be much more appealing to the public. Travelers, commuters, and tourists will be attracted to the coastal route, the result being increased ridership and greater revenues, which in turn will attract and generate outside investment in the system. The overall mileage from Bakersfield to Los Angeles via the Tehachapi route is 68 miles. Via the Southwest Las Padres route, it is 70 miles, so it's negligible. In summary, there are five distinct benefits to HSR to look at regarding the Southwest Los Padres route. Number one, it will save billions of dollars. Number two, it will reduce completion time by many years. Number three, it will allow for reasonable escape routes. Number four, it will eliminate the public discourse. And number five, it will enhance outside investment. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Follett. I appreciate those comments and your preparation of these materials. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
John Dorman, followed by Bill Descarry.
Good morning and thank you. My name is John Dorman. I am the general manager with AEG Bakersfield. We manage and operate the Rabobank Arena Theater and Convention Center here in Bakersfield. I'd like to thank you and the board for the opportunity to speak today. I've been following the evolution of the high-speed rail in Bakersfield and have great concern with the impact of the Bakersfield hybrid alignment due to the fact that it takes a significant amount of parking away from the venues that we manage. Literally all surface lot parking will be gone. Lack of parking makes it very challenging for us to attract and host the types of events we do. There's an ancillary revenue portion that I won't get into, but patron amenity and patron convenience paramount. We are pleased to see that the city and HSRA have developed an alternate alignment, the LGA, which removes any potential negative impacts to the facilities that I manage, that we manage as a team at AEG, and we support the staff's recommendation on item three, and thank you for allowing me to speak with you today.
Of course, thank you, sir. Bill Descarry, followed by Carol Bender.
I'm Bill DeCarry, Mr. Chairman and board members. It is important to briefly recap why item three is on today's agenda, how we got to this point, to give it a little bit of appreciation from a resident standpoint. As a 42-year Bakersfield resident, I've closely followed the high-speed rail project. When the draft Fresno to Bakersfield EIR was released in 2011, I was highly critical of the alignment that followed the BNSF tracks along Truxton Avenue with its 90-foot elevation over the West Side Parkway and the 30-foot elevation through town with massive destruction to our residences, schools, churches, businesses, hospital, municipal infrastructure such as Rabobank Arena, and the city's municipal services yard. Many of us expressed our anger over the alignment with letters to the editor, community voice articles, and speaking at city council meetings. Our elected officials listened, and in December 2011, the Bakersfield City Council passed on a 6-1 vote a very strong resolution opposing the high-speed rail project as currently planned. Note, not opposing high-speed rail, but opposing the project as it was planned. It destroyed our city. As a result, in 2012, the authority released a revised draft EIR with a hybrid alignment that was slightly different, but wasn't overall much better. Then the authority seemed to ignore Bakersfield for about 2 years. In May 2014, the board approved the Fresno to Bakersfield EIR, excluding the 7th Standard Road to downtown Bakersfield portion, while directing the authority staff to work with Bakersfield to resolve alignment issues. In the approval, the authority expressed the hybrid as its preferred alignment, with a provision that within 60 days' notice, it could begin constructing the portion. Many, including myself, were outraged with this action, and the next logical step was to file a lawsuit, which the city did the following month. Separate lawsuits were filed by Kern County, Mercy Hospital, and four other impacted entities. The authority did work with city staff, and the locally generated alternative, the LGA or the F Street alternative, was developed and led to settling the city's lawsuit. The LGA is far superior to that hybrid alignment. I respectfully urge the board to concur with the recommendation item three, which is to include the LGA as the preferred alternative alignment in the Bakersfield area in the soon-to-be-released draft supplemental EIR. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. DeCarry. Carol Bender, followed by Frank Oliveira.
Good morning.
those of you who've heard me speak or have personally talked to me know that I'm really not too afraid to be critical of the project. I guess I get to be sort of number one here. Although I'd like to use some of my time to reiterate my views that the high-speed rail project and the current business plan are deeply flawed, and because of this, we should probably stop the project a bit until some of these serious issues can be resolved. I also realize that despite the fact that the current business plan shows that we don't have adequate funding, ridership, private investor interest, or a majority of citizens buying into the plan, it's imperative at this juncture to focus on where I reside, Bakersfield, California, which is on today's agenda. I'll let the rest of today's audience discuss other aspects of the flawed project. Previously, the High Speed Rail Authority ignored Kern County's request to study an alignment that would have fewer significant environmental impacts. The red and blue line alignments were modified into a hybrid alignment that basically deviated only a few hundred feet from the previous proposals, not truly a different alignment, as Bill just mentioned. Complaints of adverse impacts on high numbers of homes, businesses, Mercy Hospital, and multiple city-county assets seemed to fall on deaf ears until the lawsuits came into being. The LGA with the station at F Street has been developed as a compromise, so to speak. And to even the uninformed, the LGA appears to have fewer impacts on our county and will have a far fewer adverse impacts on our quality of life. If picking between the LGA and the hybrid alignment, the LGA would win hands down upon initial evaluation. Neither alignment is great, but the LGA is definitely the better choice of the two. Recently, the media has been running editorial articles written by one or two individuals who state that the citizens do not want the LGA. These articles imply that we have had the wool pulled over our eyes, that we really need and want this hybrid alignment and the Truxton Station location. I'm here to assure you, having been actively involved in this process for at least 7 years now, I know this to be absolutely untrue. We are very anxious to see the full environmental reports and the draft EIR and participate in the public hearings and comment sessions to ensure that the LGR is a better fit. Today's decision to preliminarily recommend the LGA with an F Street alignment is not set in stone, but it is an important step to benefit our community. Given the hurdles that must be overcome, for all we know, this project may never reach Bakersfield, but having a better alignment will give us the peace of mind that if monies are eventually found and this project or a similar project is built in the future, we will have a set approved alignment to plan around in the meantime. This means that homes and other infrastructure plans can be planned in accordance with a planned concrete alignment. And if future issues arise for future generations, we will have some teeth to defend the preferred alignment. It is in all of our best interest to support the LGA F Street alignment, and I strongly urge the board to endorse it today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Bender. Frank Oliveira, followed by Adam Cohen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Frank Oliveira, and today I'm representing Mills Farms and Mike Rosa Family Trust. We respectfully request answers to the following questions pertaining to our multi-decade cherry and almond agro leases that your staff have apparently lost. What happened to our lease agreement documentation and our sensitive personal information contained within? Specifically, who has had control of our two leases and when? Where are our lease agreements? Specifically, where are they stored today? What security measures are being used to prevent any unauthorized access to our personal information under the authority's control? Were our lease agreements destroyed? If so, how and when? What is the authority's approved procedure for maintaining, securing, accessing, and destroying sensitive personal information of those that are compelled to cooperate in the California High-Speed Train Project right-of-way acquisition process? Who specifically is responsible for monitoring and supervising those security procedures? The lost leases are associated with our parcels of land that the authority is proposing to purchase all or part of for inclusion in the project. When we complied with the authority's notice of decision to appraise our parcels, We advised the authority staff, contractors, subcontractors that our six parcels were encumbered with AGRA leases, and we provided the authority staff, contractors, and subcontractors with copies of the AGRA leases associated with the parcels as requested. On February 26, 2016, we became aware that our documents were most likely lost, and we began to question the matter. By February 11th, we formally requested the authority's chief real estate officer to answer those questions about our missing documents. None of those questions were difficult or should be difficult to answer. On April 12th, we were advised that the matter was closed without providing any detailed answers to our questions about what had happened to our personal information or how it would be handled going forward. On April 12th, it became clear to us that the authority was just going to dismiss the loss of our personal documentation as insignificant and not investigate the matter. On April 13th, we made a California Public Records Request Act of the authority in an effort to reconstruct what had happened to our personal information. On April 14th, I discussed the matter directly with the chief of real estate from the authority, following a state public works board meeting. During that meeting, we briefly discussed that the reason for the California Public Records request was to reconstruct what happened to our missing documents because he had failed to answer any of our questions. On April 15th, we emailed him a recap of our conversation on April 14th. We have not heard from him since April 14th. He did not provide us with the courtesy of an acknowledgement of the mail that we had requested. On May 6th, the authority denied our public records request, citing exemption from releasing any records pursuant to California Government Code Section 6254H. 6254H reads, "The contents of real estate appraisals or engineering or feasibility estimates and evaluations made for or by the state or local agency relative to the acquisition of property or to the prospective public supply and construction contracts until all of the property has been acquired or all of the contract agreements obtained. However, the law of eminent domain shall not be affected by this provision." Our denied public records request is much broader than the contents of real estate appraisals or engineering or feasibility estimates or evaluations, and the authority's refusal to release the requested records that do not include the contents of real estate appraisals or engineering or feasibility estimates and evaluations smells as a cover-up. Attached is a new public records request that asks for the same information as before, but excluding the contents of real estate appraisals, engineering or feasibility estimates or evaluations. For clarification, we're looking for answers to our six questions, none of which have anything to do with the contents of real estate appraisals or engineering or feasibility estimates or evaluations. In closure, it is things like this that reinforce that the authority cannot be trusted to operate in a forthright matter. When will the authority answer our questions? Closed as a package of material supporting what I've said today.
Thank you, Mr. Oliveira. I'm going to ask our general counsel to take a look at this and report to the board about it. Adam Cohen, followed by Bob Bell, and then Holly King.
Good morning, Chairman Richard, members of the board. Before I begin, I'd like to comment on one of the slides made by Mark on the important farmland. So is it possible to bring up that slide and I'll proceed with my remarks?
Is it possible to bring up this slide?
Thank you. So what I want to talk to you guys about today is I've given you guys some attachments.
Is this the one, Mr. Cohen?
Yes, sir.
Thanks.
You have the electronic as well as the paper attachments. Among those are more than 80 signatures as of this morning opposing what is known as the Bakersfield F Street station alignment, opposing a station in what is known as Westchester at F Street and Golden State Avenue. And those folks unanimously say that if you are going to select LGA as the alignment, they want an alternative station studied either in Shafter, at the airport, or at some other location along the alignment, not at F Street. In addition to that, I want to point out here that Map 21 is not a new process, and it does not supersede Title VI or any of the environmental justice orders. I also have given you two other attachments. One of them is electronic. It looks like this map here. The other one here is from Mr. Morales's slide deck presented last month to, I believe it was the Strategic Growth Council. In those, you'll see on Mr. Morales's slide deck, he highlights the process, and the process that he's shown is identify a preferred alternative after preparation and circulation of draft environmental documents. Now, if you look at this map here, this is done using CalEnviroScreen, the official tool for EJ, but you can also use the EPA map, and it was generated using the authority's own GIS data. You'll see that it disproportionately impacts low-income communities, what you have here, and there's a similar map for minority communities as well. So what this raises is severe concerns, and as of yesterday, you know, your public affairs folks said, we are going to do, and I'm going to paraphrase, a separate process, but don't worry, it's going to be equal level of scrutiny. Separate, but equal. So when you look at this map, it raises serious concerns as why we would do an expedited Map 21 process. It's unfair, arbitrary, and capricious to the low-income communities that are impacted by the new route, as well as minorities, when that procedure was available and not used previously. In addition to that, I want to point out that, you know, CEQA guidelines for the state have specific language about detecting omissions and checking for accuracy. And one of the things that I want to point out here on this map used to generate the farmland, I encourage you guys to look at kind of what I'm pointing at, they have the Shafter HMF site included in their important farmland calculations right there. So these are some of the omissions and the errors that we begin to see with the staff analyses, and a lot of people have requested, multiple people have requested alternative analysis become public. This has not been provided. So we need a transparent and an accountable process where the public can comment, they can comment on omissions, detect errors, before a preferred selection is designated. You know, as people, I think as Ms. Bender noted, endorse. And that's strong language. Words have meaning.
Okay.
That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cohen. Bob Bell, followed by Holly King.
Good morning, Chair Richards, board, staff. My name is Bob Bell. I am the chairman of the Downtown Bakersfield Development Corporation. It is a 501c3. Formed for the purpose of development, better development in our downtown. It's a creative way, and especially in the state of California, and getting the community a voice. I also was previous chair of the Downtown Business Association, still serve on that board. I want to respond to the meetings and things that we've heard a lot of claims that were not being included. I, for one, am tired of meetings. So for many, many years now, staff, city, county, Kern Cog, city manager's offices, they have not only been inclusive, they have given us a great voice. They put us on steering committees, they put us as part of surveys, they've worked with us on every possible point. We've met with council members. We're getting a voice, and we're being heard, and we're being listened to. I'm a developer by trade, been doing it for 39 years. I want to tell you that the F Street alignment is by far a better alignment for development. I'll give you a couple points that have been pushed back at us. For instance, the water issue over there. So I'm from Stockton and East Bay. We have expansive soil in those areas, and yet we're able to mitigate that with concrete treated base, lime treated base, other types of resources to make that better. I know with our good soil, changing the waterway and making that developable is a kind of an easy solution. So I just want to let you know as a board and as an authority that they're working hard with us, and we're getting a voice and we're listening. There are 400 to 500 members that are either business or property owners in downtown, and surveying them, we had the large majority prefer the F Street alignment. So not only, here's another little point, not only are we involved in their steering committees, but they're actually involved in our board. So they're ex officio members, but they're sitting in with us, they're encouraging us, and I just want you to know that Bakersfield is glad that you're here. There's a lot to be done, and let's get on with this process. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Bell. Holly King, followed by Beatrice Sanders.
Good morning.
Morning.
I'm Holly King, for those of you who don't know me, but I'm both a citizen living in the city of Bakersfield, but also a member of a farming operation that farms in the Bakersfield, Wasco, and Shafter areas. Thanks for coming to Bakersfield. You gave me an opportunity to get on my jeans and wear a suit for a change. I appreciate it. I just wanted to comment, we do not have any ground on the proposed alignment, but we do up in the Wasco area, so we have worked very successfully with you and appreciate the back and forth conversation. There's a couple of things that I just wanted to share with you today. When I read the staff report regarding the LGA, or the locally generated alternative, it indicates, and I quote, "The alignment was generated through discussions between the city of Bakersfield and the authority," end of quote. I would really like to echo what Mr. Hurlburt indicated, that there is an entire community that's impacted by this choice. And I took it upon myself to contact the farmers along this alignment. And I did find farmers who were not aware of this. And I also found farmers that had not been contacted. And there aren't millions of them. There's only about 10. So I would really encourage interaction with the stakeholders and an on-the-ground look at what these impacts are. Because pulling the coming from the BNSF after it goes through Wasco and Shafter, it across the Burbank alignment goes straight across prime farmland, as you saw on the maps. I also wanted to just suggest that, or ask, if there were any other alternatives besides the hybrid considered. We know the hybrid's not going to get approved. You've been sued on it once before. I doubt you'll go back for more. And I've been told that there are other alternatives that were looked at, but to date, those of us who have asked for the information on those alternatives to know what they are and what the pros and cons have not received any information on them. My point here is that rather, no matter where the alignment goes, someone is going to be impacted, whether it's residential, commercial, industrial, agriculture. So it seems that a broader analysis of the alternatives to find the least impactful is appropriate. Studying one alternative does not get us there, in my opinion. I was early on struck by the fact that this preferred or preliminary preferred alignment does not have as many impacts on farmland as the hybrid. When I got the staff report, I could see where those numbers were, or what was generating that by the numbers that were shown in here. And I want to just remind you of our experience in Wasco. The waters of the U.S., I'm going to guess, because I don't have the analysis in front of me, were done using a PJD, which is a flyover, it's a preliminary jurisdictional determination, which is what was done in Wasco. And when we got biologists, and we worked with you on this, out on the ground, there were absolutely no wetlands. We had the soils checks, the vegetation checked, and so forth. And I'm not indicating your information was wrong. You used the process that was available to you, but there is another process available, and that's actually getting out onto the ground. And this is significant for more than one reason. There are, to me, three issues here. One is looking at whether it's the important farmland or the waters, it leads you to a very important decision using those numbers. So it's important that they're real and that they're right. But also, it creates a mitigation requirement, and the taxpayers are going to have to pay for that mitigation requirement. So we want to get the numbers right. And the other thing that happens, it's more of a landowner issue, is that once things are declared wetlands, whether they are or not, it creates a huge problem on our surface. At the end of the day, the impacts to farmland and waters of the U.S. need to be correct and real, because we're making important decisions based on those numbers. This project will impact someone going through Kern County. Consequently, an analysis of the alternatives, not just one alternative, should be conducted with stakeholders both in and outside the city of Bakersfield, and an on-ground assessment of the impacts, not one from the air, not one conducted with interactions, but one with interactions of those who are impacted. After all, this is going to change the face of our community. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. King. Beatrice Sanders, followed by Anthony Amarante, I believe it is.
Good morning, or maybe almost afternoon. Beatrice Sanders, Kern County Farm Bureau, where we represent 1,400 growers here in Kern County. I am also from a farming family and a homeowner in the city of Shafter, though our own family's acreage is not affected by the high-speed rail routes. I am here on behalf of the Greater Farm Bureau and those farmers whose land is affected. Agriculture, as you may know, plays a major role in producing food for our nation. Kern County specifically is the second highest producing agricultural county in the nation. Out of the top six private employers in Kern County, three of them come from the agricultural industry. Though at the Kern County Farm Bureau, we do not support or oppose the high-speed rail. The reality is that no matter where the alignment goes through Kern County, a farmer will be impacted. Before naming the preferred alignment, we do prefer to see that accurate and transparent research has been done. It seems that a broader and more detailed study of various alternatives to determine the alignment with the least impact to farmland would be appropriate. Studying one alignment appears to stop short of that. We do appreciate your efforts in sending staff to visit with our Kern County Farm Bureau Board of Directors. They frequently visit with their updates to the high-speed rail alignments and how they affect agricultural land. However, we would like more transparency in our communications with your staff. Given the many issues farmers face day to day, besides the high-speed rail concerns, our farmers often don't know the appropriate questions or the right questions to ask your staff. For example, just learning today, in the two proposed alignments, it appears that the impacts to agricultural land may be skewed. It is important to get the size of the impacts correct in order to make a decision, but also because if it goes to mitigation, this will cost the public taxpayer dollars. We hope that this can be a regional conversation, transparent to organizations like ours and our members. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Sanders. Anthony, I hope I have this right, Amarante? Mr. Amarante? Lewis Gill, followed by Brian Forrest.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Bakersfield.
Thank you.
You guys sure know how to stir things up, I'll give you that.
Oh, this is easy compared to some of the things we do.
For the last 16 years, I've had the privilege of working for an organization called the Bakersfield Homeless Center. I'm not here to argue the merits of either alignment, because we are one of the few properties in town where both alignments meet at our facility. We're a 174-bed family shelter. We serve primarily women and children. On any given night, we have somewhere between 80 and 100 children sleeping at our facility. There's nowhere else in our community for these families to go. There's just not another alternative. In 2015, we were notified by the authority that our campus would be affected. Not only infected, but you would need the entire campus, multiple buildings, all of our services. This has kind of started a clock on two different problems. One, we're a facility that gets used hard every day by hundreds of people. requires regular maintenance. When you have a line drawn through your facility, your donors begin to sit on the sidelines and wonder what's going to happen. And so repairs that we need to do to be able to maintain a quality of service that every citizen deserves, they just aren't happening. Because the people that support us truly are waiting to find out what's going to happen. When's the shoe going to drop? The other piece is that if we have to relocate a campus that serves several hundred homeless people a day, there's not very many neighborhoods that regularly, consistently welcome that kind of population. It's going to take time. We need to start this work now. It's not going to happen overnight. Relocating a special use nonprofit like ours is going to take a lot of work. I want to say thank you. We have had the opportunity to meet with staff on more than one occasion, but we need to move forward. I believe you guys do have some experience with a homeless facility in Fresno. It was a little different. It was a much smaller take, and there was adjacent land that was available, and so it was easily remedied. Well, easily. Let's not use that word. It appears to have been remedied. But for us, on behalf of the people that we serve, I would request that you charge staff with moving forward as quickly as possible for early acquisition of our facility. As an unintentional consequence of both alignments is truly limiting how we are going to serve the least in our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gill. Brian Forrest, followed by Kevin Bush. Mr. Forrest. Mr. Forrest. Okay. Kevin Bush, followed by Marvin Dean.
Chairman Richard, staying board, President Morales. Do I give you documents? Can I give the board documents?
If you can give them to the board secretary.
Okay. Thanks for allowing me to speak today. I have representing the Kern County Black Chamber of Commerce. We are in support of the high-speed rail. We are very in support of the heavy maintenance facility. There are some concerns that we do have, and it's primarily with the process. I began attending the public meetings. I submitted comment cards, and the first comment card I submitted, I personally was in favor of the hybrid. And I received a response, which is in the documents that I presented to you, thanking me for my support of the F Street location. That was the first. So I began communicating back and forth with the authority, and I received some correspondence that, you know, I needed to communicate with the city. As the city began its process of the station area plan, and I did so, I joined the steering committee, and I was began making recommendations because it seems as if the proposed alignment disproportionately affected minority and low-income communities. And I submitted correspondence relating to that and possible Title VI violations. In talking with the city, we submitted a map, which is in, I'll show you the map here. We drew a map. This is an overlay map, which I think you saw it earlier, which is a disadvantage, a map of disadvantaged communities. And the new alignment leaves an alignment that would affect all communities and is now just disproportionately affecting low-income and minority communities. I came briefly to just ask you guys to table item 3 so that we could get more involved in understanding what's going to happen to our communities. The word, if we can just do one thing, and that would be the word preferred. To me, preferred means preferred. Preliminarily preferred means first preferred, which would mean that would be the hybrid location, which would be your first preferred location. So I'm kind of confused with all the language that's going on, and since I'm new to this political process, I'd like some help from the board. So if we could at least remove the language, I would appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Bush. Marvin Dean, followed by Alan Scott, and then Sherilyn Smith. Where'd Marvin go? Oh, there he is. Right in front of me. Yeah, I looked up.
Good evening, I guess.
No, it's morning still.
Morning. I'm thinking about this evening. But let me say, first of all, I'm just going to make a few observation of what happens today. And first of all, I want to say I'm here representing the San Joaquin Valley High Speed Rail Association and the Kern Minority Contractors Association. And I also want to say that some of you know I'm on your Business Advisory Council. And we thank you very much for the 30% goal for small business and also the community benefits agreement. At the last board meeting I attended was in Anaheim. I did give you guys heads up that there was a lot of your friends that are concerned with the high-speed rail. It was going to be coming back at you with this environmental justice stuff, and potentially there may be some challenges brought to the authority. And I support the high-speed rail authority, and I support this project. And I don't want to see anything to slow this project down. So I would just say, take that seriously and try to address those concerns. The other thing I want to say, Team Fresno, I want to commend Team Fresno. Team Fresno has put on and been doing this for a long time. And I think we here in Kern County, for a long time, I've been a lonely voice standing up here championing high-speed rail in this community. And I'm glad now to see others have taken the stand up and now pushing this high-speed rail maintenance facility. But I think we need to be looking at jobs. We need to be looking at the whole host of things that Team Fresno is looking at. And I think we can learn from the city of Team Fresno. And I've asked Leanne Agert to come and speak at our luncheon that we're going to have on Friday to give us some tips about what they're doing so we can bring all the segments of our community together to champion this project so we can get the best project that's going to come to our valley. I want to also say a little bit about Bill when he talked about, say, Bakersfield, when they opposed the high-speed rail and the lawsuit was filed, just a little reminiscing. I remember when Jeff was first hired, brought onto this board, we hosted a luncheon for Jeff, and I think Tom Richards came with him. And I think that was the turn, because I've always said in those meetings that you're going to see a whole new leadership of this board under the auspice of Jeff Morales in terms of wanting to work with this community. Because you heard before all the conversation was we're being imposed, nobody listening to us, all of those things. And I remember a meeting that Mr. Tandy had in his office when Jeff and the attorneys and everybody talked about this process. And I said then, and you all knew, Mr. Tandy, that under this leadership it was going to be a turning. So I'm very pleased with what the city has come in, spoke in support of this alternative local route, even though there's still some challenges. But the fact that I think that everybody know that now this authority and the leadership of under Jeff is working with our community, and it's not being something that's not being taken in consideration of what we want in this community. So I want to commend both of you all, the city and the authority. Now, I want to say this before I get into my main crux of being here. I have not taken a position on the routing, because when this project goes through, goes south, before it gets to the homeless shelter, it's going to take out my building. So I, too, will be affected by this project. For this reason, I can't take it would be unfair for me, because somebody's going to be affected, for me to say I support it, but don't take my land, take this other person's land. I would say your decision ought to be who's going to impact the least amount of ag farm land, prime farm land, impact the least amount of people, and do it from a standpoint that what's fair, and whoever's going to be make those people whole. So that's my position on it. And the San Joaquin Valley High Speed Rail Association is concerned about the entire 9 counties of the Central Valley. This maintenance yard, I'd love to see it here in Bakersfield, but if it don't, I want to see it in the valley. So I'm equally speaking for all 9 counties of this valley, even though I live here in Bakersfield.
and I think you all will make the best decision in terms of where to put that facility and what's best for this valley. Now, I want to make two announcements, and I'll sit down. I want to give a special thank you to your board chairman, Dan Richards, because he has agreed to now let us host him in Bakersfield for a reception, a community reception that we're going to do tonight at the Marriott Hotel at 5:30 to 8:30. And I would say to everybody in the sound of my voice, we invite the entire community, come out, and let's have an opportunity to host the chairman, let him hear from the city of Bakersfield what our concerns are, and at the same time, let him come in and talk with us about some of the things that might be a benefit to us. So I want to say that. 5:30 at the Bakersfield Marriott Hotel, it would be in Ballroom B. Now, that's the kickoff of the Small Business Week that we're doing. We're going to be doing four other events, and I gave you guys that handout there. Tomorrow, we're going to be having a walk through our training facility that we're opening up here in Bakersfield to make sure people are ready for the community benefit agreements and also the contracts to get our people ready in this town. The Thursday evening, we're going to be hosting a mixer at the Marriott, and also we'll be hosting the downtown business stakeholder downtown station planning meeting that'll be also there, because we're going to give a downtown station, and we're now part of a work group that the city has put together, 35-member task force, to look at what we want to see with the high-speed rail station. We're hosting that as well in the afternoon. And the last thing is we're going to have a general conference on Friday at the Marriott. It'll be general sessions, breakout sessions. We'll have a vendor booth there. We'll have a luncheon and a whole host of programs to make sure our people in this community know about the job opportunity and the contracts, and we get ready for it. Because the bottom line, $6 billion is going to be spent in this valley. It's about who's going to get the jobs and the contracts. And if we don't fight to get our people ready, everybody know they're going to be flocking in from all over the country into this valley. It's going to be a missed opportunity. And so I'll leave it there. I know you gave me a couple of extra minutes before you told me to sit down. And I would say to our media and our business community, let's help all get the word out to our people to make sure our people know about the opportunity. Because if we don't do it, shame on us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dean. Alan Scott, followed by Sherilyn Smith.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Alan Scott, I'm a member of Citizens for California High-Speed Rail Accountability in Kings County. And I'm coming before you this morning with some troubling concerns. In doing some research, I discovered that the state of California, according to a 2015 Truth in Accounting report, California is the seventh worst debtor state in the country. Furthermore, Moody's just announced the indebtedness rating for California as F. June 30th, 2014, a California Comprehensive Financial Report concluded that $150.1 billion promise for retirement benefits was unfunded. However, the state only reported $38.8 billion on the balance sheet, thus making this report wrong. This accounting maneuver was off by a total of $111.13 billion. I know this is not to your board, but I'm asking the question because somehow or other you're looking for funding for tomorrow. And I'm looking at a report that I researched online from this agency, and they said you were short, not you, the state was short $111.13 billion off the balance sheet. I'm questioning just overall the whole balance process, the whole accounting process. Between 2014 and 2015, total California state spending increased by $41.7 billion. I thought we were in a recession. It went from $210.9 billion in 2014 to $252.6 billion in 2015, equating to a 16.49% increase. Why did we need Prop 30? I thought we were broke. February 6, 2016, San Francisco Chronicle reports indebtedness worries by analysts. Analysts are worried about the indebtedness of the state of California. This creates a number of questions, beginning with the wonder, I wonder why. Why are the analysis people, the financial people, concerned about the state of California? Well, I'm probably going to tell you here in just a minute. Moving on, one of the things that was interesting when I was doing my research, trying to find out the total funded, unfunded debt relationship to the state of California. So I ended up with somewhere between $400 billion and $778 billion of indebtedness. I don't know which number it is, somewhere in between, some of the lower number, the higher number. It was very interesting. The bottom line is that the state of California is number 9 in the nation in indebtedness liabilities. That much I did find. Once again, I remind this board, upon arrival in California back in 1974, the spring, you were number 1 in almost every reportable benchmark in the world. You probably were not even under, above 10 on any of the benchmarks, education, anything, financial standards, whatever. Today, it's the exact reverse. The state is hovering at the bottom of the pile in every position possible. I'm going to skip ahead here and go on to some. So right now, with all of the talk about the high-speed rail and everything else, any logical, clear-thinking individual, after reviewing what is on the authority's books today, without question, would remove HSR designation and now call it the new Amtrak, traveling close to the existing Amtrak routes and the speeds that they will achieve in a few years. So bottom line is, with all your twists and turns and everything else, I don't think you're in the designation of a high-speed rail. You may be 1 mile above or below it, but it's questionable. When you look at the routing from San Francisco to L.A. or to Bakersfield, depending on which, or to Wasco or to Shafter, it's very confusing because a lot of twists and turns. We're not sure if there's a lot of backroom deals going on. In December 2015, you guys determined you couldn't cross the mountains. So the two mountains to the east of us and south of us, southeast of us, couldn't be done. However, over the next few months, you hear there's a station here, not going to be here, here going to be, is another station, here's another station, no, we're going to take this one out, we're going to reroute this, we can't make it to the Transbay Terminal, and so on and so forth. Pretty disconcerting. However, I have one point in Fresno.
And Mr. Scott, I've been pretty liberal, but...
I know. Let me just finish this, please. This is important.
All right.
The authority still has one severe concern in Fresno at the Lemoore Cleaners plant on G Street. This is a Superfund. Why are you moving forward taking land when this site will take years to mitigate? I thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Sherilyn Smith, and followed by, I apologize, it's either Mr. or Ms. Seward from Wilson Street. I couldn't read the first name, so I'm sorry. Ms. Smith?
Yes, I'm Sherilyn Smith, an environmental activist and an educator from Fresno. Having to do with what Mr. Scott just said about taking land, I happen to want to address something I've never had an opportunity to bring up before, and that is the process of eminent domain that so many people in Fresno are experiencing. I see that as your modus operandi. I don't see much else going on. And the thing that triggers that is called RON, R-O-N, resolution of necessity. Now, given what a couple of speakers or more have talked about, the Tehachapi crossing, the San Gabriel Mountains, and the inability that you have to come up with a clear construction plan for doing that at this point in time, really puts this project in limbo, let's face it. It is not completable as we speak. So where does that word necessity come in to Iran? This project has not produced the validity to call it a resolution of necessity. And I think it's time that people, and I'm giving a heads up to this community who may be affected by that in the very near future. We need to say, you need to show us how this project will be completed in verifiable terms before you can issue resolutions of necessity. And to change to another subject, as an environmental activist, I want to reiterate some things I may have told you before. This project, as the LAO has identified, is a 30-year net polluter. It will take, no doubt, another 30 years to undo the damage that you do during construction. On top of that, Dan Walters of Sacramento Bee has pointed out that it's only going to take 1 year's of car, 1 year's worth of cars off the road over a 58-year period, hardly worth the billions and billions of dollars that you are projected to spend on this project, and as we all know, will probably double over the years. Especially given that fact that that's all it's doing totally for the transportation in California, is taking 1 year's worth of cars off the road. What right do you have to use CNT funds, cap and trade? I see the relationship between high-speed rail and cap and trade as a parasitic one. And some of you up there have demonstrated that in Sacramento and at other board meetings, of your board meetings. I've heard Mr. Richard, Mr. Morales both say, we need a steady, stable stream of revenue to come from cap and trade in order to attract investors. That has a pull on the program. And because I see you as the spoiled children of Jerry Brown, I think it does play out in cap and trade.
Ms. Smith, you have every right to express your opinions, but I'll ask you to limit them to opinions about the project and not make ad
hominem comments. No, as far as cap and trade goes, you're defeating the environmental goals of that program, because in order for it to succeed, revenues have to diminish steadily, not stay the same, not increase, and not be fed to this program. It's dragging on cap and trade program and reducing our ability to meet greenhouse gas reductions. And I think that's very relevant, very, very relevant. It has to do with the monies that we put out as taxpayers at the fuel tax, at the pump, and in all kinds of ways. You're draining money and bleeding it from the citizens of California. So while you claim to be putting in offsets for environmental reasons as you do your construction, you claim to be, you should have already said, I understood that you should have already been planting trees. That's not happening. But even if it were, think about the kid in Fresno who's choking because he has asthma out in the, say, roading school, which is very near the rail, as 12 trains per day are whizzing by and stirring up particulate matters, of which Fresno has the worst rating in the nation and the highest asthma rate. You tell that kid who's being rushed to the hospital, you tell his parents, oh, you're going to be all right. We planted those trees over there. Your offsets need to be very direct and very truly addressing the problems that you're bound to be creating as you construct this project.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. Okay, next, and I apologize again. I just can't read the first name. Is it Ms. Seward, Mr. Seward? Okay. Jason Carter, followed by Patrick Jackson.
Good afternoon, Chairman. Actually, it is afternoon now.
It is, yes.
And members of the board, my name is Jason Cater.
I'm sorry, Mr. Cater.
No,
excuse me.
No problem. 29 years I've had it almost every other day, so not a problem. Come here as the vice chair of the Downtown Business Development Corporation. You heard from Bob, our chair, earlier, and also I serve on the board of Bike Bakersfield, a local nonprofit that promotes biking for everyday transportation. Served on that group for 4.5 years on staff and 2.5 years as a director. And also, I am born and raised in Bakersfield, left for college, not to Fresno, and came home, as we heard earlier from Lauren, but went to the coast of San Luis Obispo and studied planning, and then came home and have worked here for the last 7 years. And as someone who loves downtown, who lives in Westchester for the last 2.5 years, has worked and played in downtown for the last 5 or 6 years, I just want to address kind of, I know we've heard a lot today about people who do and don't support the project, people who are looking at one alignment or the other, but I want to focus just on the conversation. I know Chairman Richard, you earlier said that this process with the city of Bakersfield for years seemed adversarial, and really as someone on the outside who would come to these meetings and would see the input, you would hear more from people who were just against the project rather than people who came for support. When you read the paper, it really was more about what lawsuits were coming, what group opposed it, who was, who wasn't. I just want to come here today as we talk about the preferred alignment, what we're going to study. The conversation in the last year and a half when the LGA came out has changed the conversation with this city and the board, and to see the two groups go from being adversarial to being at the table to look for a consensus. As you said earlier, Chairman Richard, when you have cities that are opposing high-speed rail or fighting for their cities, you see it as them protecting their constituents rather than them wanting to be adversaries. And I think that when both groups are on the same page on agreement for what the opportunities are and what we're moving towards, I think that's when opportunities and progress happens. And what the city of Bakersfield has been doing with the High-Speed Rail Authority since studying the LGA has been very positive. Having attended the downtown planning meetings, it's exciting for me to, as a big downtown person again, to have gone from just seeing the negativity in the papers to now seeing people come together and look at what does this project mean for downtown Bakersfield and the city as a whole for the next, you know, 30 to 40 years. And as someone who plans to spend the next 35 to 40 years of his career and his life in this city and working and playing in this, in downtown particularly, I think we're really moving in a positive direction. I thank you guys in your collaboration with the city, working towards an agreement, a consensus, and again, what decision comes to today, let's always remember that I think the best things happen when groups work together and move towards a positive consensus. And obviously there's concerns that the audience have raised today that need to be addressed, but we're moving in the right direction. I think since looking at the LGA, we've really seen a positive shift in the momentum of this project. So I want to thank you guys for being here today and meeting with our city, and I look forward to seeing how this project continues moving forward.
Thank you, Mr. Cater. Patrick Jackson, followed by Alexis Smith.
Morning, Chair, Board. My name is Patrick Jackson, President of the NAACP. From the beginning of this project, we've been in support of this particular high-speed rail alignment. But as we've been looking at it furthermore, we've seen some of the issues that have with the new alignment, the preferred alignment, that the language that has been used here readily, that is ultimately impacting low-income and minority communities from an economic standpoint. And I think that most people that are looking at this project as it's moving forward, I believe it's going to be a great project for the city of Bakersfield, for Kern County, but also looking at it from a perspective that is impacting all communities, that it has to be inclusive to all the communities as we're moving forward to make sure that all people are included in this project that will be impacted by this project. I believe that's very important that we look into that, and also the decision that's being made from an environmental standpoint, that we are looking to make sure that this impact is long-term and that we are looking into it thoroughly. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Alexis Smith, followed by Kathleen, we'll be moving into the Acton area, Kathleen Trinity from Acton. Alexis Smith. Let me start with town council members from Acton. First, Jacqueline Ayer, Pam, and followed by Pam Walter. Council member Ayer. Pam Walter from Acton. Okay, can I ask somebody on staff to go check? Because Acton's a long way for people to drive. I don't want to cut them off. Is Kathleen Trinity here? Okay. Ms. Trinity, why don't I ask you to just wait 1 second. Okay. Councilmember Ayer?
Thank you very much. A few weeks ago, I provided to this board a figure from your latest Supplemental Alternatives Analysis report that clearly shows Acton's legally established boundaries, and it demonstrates what I've been saying for years. There are no routes that you've proposed on the Palmdale-Burbank segment that don't devastate Acton. The engineered drawings of the vertical profile for the Palmdale-Burbank segment show that you can easily underground the portion of the SR-14 route that is above ground and about 1,000 feet from our brand new high school. This can be done without affecting any other portion of the alignment. Doing so would only increase the total tunnel length by a mile, and it wouldn't create any tunnel systems that are too long or are unbuildable. This would save all of North Acton. Similarly, your engineering drawings for the forest routes also show that it is easy to underground the tracks at Aliso Canyon without affecting the remainder of any portion of the route. Doing so would not create a tunnel system that is either too long or unbuildable. This would save all of Southern Acton. The High Speed Rail Authority must give Acton the same regard that it has given to other communities like Santa Clarita, Lakeview Terrace, and San Fernando. As the Acton Town Council has pointed out over and over, Acton is the only community in the entire Palmdale to Burbank segment that is not protected by at least one underground route. That needs to change. We've seen your engineering drawings. We met with your engineers yesterday. We showed them how it can be done. So it needs to be done. Thank you very much. And if you didn't get this, I can give you this copy here, but it demonstrates where Acton's legally established boundaries are. It's not just
could you give that to our board secretary, please?
Thank you. I'm Jacqueline Eyre with the Acton Town Council.
Okay. Pam Walter, followed by Kathleen Trinity.
Well, good morning, Dan Richard, and everyone else on the board. My statements are going to sound kind of similar to Jackie now that I've heard Jackie speak, but I'll go forward with that anyway. I'm on the Acton Town Council, and I'm also a 25-year resident of Acton and a 25-year president of the Acton Aqua Dulce Brokers Association. So, of course, I'm very concerned about property values and everything else that's going on in Acton. The High Speed Rail Authority engineers wants Acton to do what Bakersfield has done, which is to draw a line on the map that Acton can live with. That's impossible for Acton to do since the engineers persist in drawing routes that all have above ground sections through Acton. We've met with the engineers many, many times over the years, and they persist. Like Jackie just said, we met with them again yesterday, hoping that we could come to some kind of understanding of what they were trying to accomplish and what we need for our community. You have given other communities in Southern California underground routes, but not Acton. How can you expect us to pick a route when all of the choices you have given us are not acceptable and they're destructive to Acton? The fiscal impact of giving Acton underground routes is negligible. Believe me, we've done our research. We don't sprout off without knowing the facts. We don't come here uneducated. One of the routes is 1,000 feet from our brand new high school, which is still under construction. Our community has struggled for years to provide a new high school for our students and families, and now that dream is severely impacted by the high-speed rail. Therefore, that above-ground section, 1,000 feet from our school, is not acceptable to Acton, the residents, and our students. We all want our students, our high school students, to have an acceptable education. That's what we're trying to provide. We're a community of 7,500 people, and believe me, it was difficult to get this bond issue passed for our high school. Our school board has worked beyond the call of duty to provide this normal facility for every community. Obviously, the sound barrier won't do enough to protect our students at our school. Again, we've done our research. The big picture of what the high-speed rail will do to the small, historic community, rural community of Acton by these above-ground routes is devastating. Just like Santa Clarita, San Fernando, and other cities, Acton deserves better planning and engineering by the High-Speed Rail Authority. Not only will this affect severely our rural lifestyle and what people are drawn to Acton for, which is the ruralness, the horses, the dogs, the proximity of not having a neighbor within 100 feet of you, all of that. We've all worked hard to be able to live in Acton. It's not a first-time home buyers community, and I hear that and I'm done. We can't just think about today, but the impact of the loss of property values, now I'm speaking as a realtor, for the next many years. How can that be justified? I can't see it. We've talked about this for years now in Acton. In my mind, it can't be. I look forward to you, Mr. Richard, to working with me and my community to get those engineers back on board with us to try to help us figure out how we can put this underground. If you can do that for us, that's all I'm asking you. And you told me you'd come back to our community.
And I will.
And I'm asking you again, come back to Acton. I'll put you in my car, tour you around, show you everything, and why we need your help. It's my town. I'm fighting for it.
Thank you, Council Member. Kathleen Trinity. Thank you for your patience, Ms. Trinity.
It's okay. Good afternoon, Chairman Richard and Board. All communities must be treated with attention and respect. Cost-cutting at the community level, such as bringing rail to ground or on a viaduct rather than going underground, can be unfair and unwise in the long run. Driving down the quality of communities to cut costs leads to demographic changes that reach beyond town and city boundaries. In rural communities such as Acton, this means loss of housing, loss of recreation, and loss of equine-related businesses and even other businesses. Horses are not cows. They are very sensitive to loud, abrupt noises, such as trains entering a tunnel. The mass exodus of equestrians and their horses will have far-reaching consequences upon our community. In and above or at ground rail, works in a relatively flat community, or even in the hills of Spain, that doesn't mean it will work in Acton. We're a mountain community and adjustments have to be made. We know who we are and we know how our community works. Walls to mitigate don't do much good in the mountains where the sound jumps around. You can have all the connectivity in the world, but if you destroy communities, all you've created is an elitist travel route. Ordinary people aren't going to be able to afford a daily round-trip ticket to work. In the meantime, you may have destroyed their community. Not to go underground is to treat affected communities cheaply. Please make the routes underground in Acton. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Trinity. I apologize, I'm having trouble reading this next one. It's Terry, I'm not sure if it's McDowell, Pines. I'm sorry, sir?
Maxwell,
that was going to be my second or third choice. Mr. Maxwell, I'm sorry, sir.
That's okay. My name's Terry Maxwell. I'm actually a city councilman here in Bakersfield.
Well, I'm also sorry that we ended up at the back of the list.
That's okay. I heard a lot of good things here today, and if I had gotten to speak earlier, I probably would have left. And I do apologize. I run a restaurant and I own a restaurant, and so I had to do a catering.
You look otherwise, a lot more comfortable than we are.
Today. Yeah. And I'd spoken to you to this board before. It was on a Thursday morning about a year and a half ago. I know it was a Thursday morning because the night before we'd had a city council meeting, and I sat right over there where Ms. Schenek is. So I at that time had recommended that the board get a copy of a book called The Vanishing Automobile and Other Urban Myths, because I think it very, very well defines the fact that high-speed rail is something that was discovered in the 1890s, and we're trying to solve problems in 2016 with 1890s technology. I think there's other ways that we could be spending our money, but I did notice in this spending of money, which we're already talking about billions that you've spent, when I watched Fresno come up with their lobbyists and everybody with, as well as they presented their argument in Kern County and Madera, it reminds me of, I guess, sharks with blood in the water. They're seeing the money, and everybody would like to get that heavy maintenance facility in their areas because they do view that as something that is going to be beneficial to their communities, bring in resources. And I don't blame them one bit. But at the end of the day, I think that you understand as a board, you're going to make some people real, real happy, and you're going to make some people real, real sad, and some people real, real angry. And I guess sometimes it's a question of how many people or to what extent that's going to happen. I do represent the downtown area where the F Street station would go. I also represent the downtown area where the Truxton station would have gone if it were the one that were chosen. And I think both of them have impacts that are really tough to define. It's not so much the homes that you lose, it's the people that are left there that have a high-speed rail running past them every day. And I don't know how many times a day that's going to be, and I know that in this community we've never heard one go by us before. I don't know if they're real loud or not, but they're going to be fairly high. And for the community of Westchester, if it's going to go in the F Street area, I think everybody's worried there about what kind of quality of life are they going to have if so many times a day a high-speed rail train is going to go by and it creates enough noise that it's disturbing the neighborhood. So I would ask that as you do the environmental impact, that's the major consideration for my constituents. How is it going to change my quality of life? Because sometimes we look at the environment and say, well, it's not going to do this to some of the things that the government thinks it's important to, but my constituents think what it does to their lives is important. And I'd like you to consider that. If there's a way you can mitigate that sound, either by putting up very tall walls to keep the sound from that neighborhood, I would highly recommend you consider it. You're going to spend billions of dollars anyway. What's another $200 million for a wall, right? The other concern they have is that in Bakersfield area, because of unemployment, because of some of the impacts that we have, they think that the F Street station might draw kind of the wrong element and would kind of spill over into the neighborhood. I mean, we already in Bakersfield have a huge problem with crime. You know, I'm advocating that we increase the number of police officers we have, but that central location, either whether it be on Truxton or whether it be in F Street, could lead to undesirable people hanging out. I know that the station's going to be open probably 24 hours a day because the trains are going to be running at that extent. So you might help my citizens, help my constituents, by letting them know that there are going to be some security things you're going to do in the future once it does open that will help to make sure that their community is going to be secure, that train station is going to be secure, and that you have a plan in place so that it doesn't, as I say, spill over. When I talked to you before, one of the things that I had advocated was if you're going to come through Bakersfield, and I think this is a little late to say it again, but if you're going to come through Bakersfield, why not put your station on to the west of Bakersfield? We have a beautiful get bus system. We have ways that we can, inside our community, make it easy for people to get on a bus, go out to a station that would be west of town, have the least amount of impact on our community. And if the high-speed rail is going to function as it should to get people through this area and down into the Los Angeles or up to San Francisco in an efficient manner, I think that would have worked very, very nicely. I think at this point, you know, the baby's already been thrown out. So I'm sorry that wasn't a consideration because I think it would have really been done well for this community to have it so that it did not take out any homes and that it could have gone to the west of Bakersfield and as it went through could have looped around to the south of Bakersfield and again not taken out any homes. So I thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you, Council Member. Rebecca Whitcomb. And Ms. Whitcomb, you are the last speaker.
Yay, me. It's a big impact. Good afternoon. My name is Major Rebecca Whitcomb, USMC retired. Thank you very much for opening this proceeding with the Pledge of Allegiance. I think that that particular action really reminds us that we are not only Californians, but we're also Americans. And being a Californian who served our nation for 22 years, it gave me the opportunity to go forward and become a strategic warfighter. I, in 2009, was not in California. I was in the desert of Iraq defending our nation and doing the best that I could do to make sure that my family and that Kern County people were protected through my service. And I want to talk today about the international and innovative opportunity that we have as Californians to lead the world in terms of having a dream about how to lead not only environmentalism and also transportation, but also in being able to push forward in an idea and being able to inspire others. On my Mother's Day, my husband drug me to his solar site, and I got to meet an Argentinian delegation who came here to look at renewable energy in Kern County. We were located on the Kern County side. There's a distinct difference between Kern County and LA County in terms of environmental friendliness and also the willingness of the Kern County leadership, Ms. Lorelei, to ensure that businesses are available and international businesses are drawn to Kern County in order to proceed with innovative technologies and other things that can perpetuate the innovation of Americans in the world. And when I was meeting with us, I was not meeting. I was serving drinks and I was gripping and grinning and saying, buenas tardes. And it was awesome because they were super happy to be meeting a Californian that was here that cared about renewable energy. And I think the high-speed rail is another kind of thing that we are looking forward to in terms of being able to inspire others and show our innovation and how we can be a leader. And I don't understand the short-sightedness of others that are just talking about their individual efforts. In Marine Corps warfighting and in joint warfighting in general, we talk about the tactical, operational, and strategic levels of war. We have been listening all day long about tactical and operational level issues, and this is a strategic issue for Californians to lead the world. Why bicker? Why complain? Why not trust in the leadership that we voted for and the leadership that we can embrace so that they can do their jobs, work out the individual issues so that we can get on with it and that we can enjoy this opportunity? All of this stuff about noise, I'm going to tell you something about the rail. In the 1970s, my mother went down to the unemployment office, and she became a trainman for Southern Pacific Railroad because we were in poverty. I was born in Bakersfield, California. I lived out in the sticks in an agricultural community, and we were in poverty, and my mother needed a job. And Southern Pacific Railroad made sure that children like me could actually aspire to their dreams. I have a master's level education through my service and through the inspiration of my mother and my father being part of the rail system. And so whoever thinks that they're sitting at school and they're worrying about the noise, that might actually be a noise that's going to inspire someone else to push forward in their education, push forward in their opportunities, and represent freedom, not actually a distraction from their learning. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Major. I want to thank all the citizens who came here today to speak to us. Many people came from long distances, and I know it was a long morning, but we very much appreciate your input. I'm going to move some items on our agenda so that we move the information items to the back and we take the action items up front. We'll just start with quickly considering the board minutes from the April 21st meeting. Do I have a motion on that? Okay, it was moved by Director Lowenthal, seconded by Vice Chair Richards. Secretary, please call the roll.
Director Schenck?
Yes.
Vice Chair Richards?
Yes.
Director Curtin?
Yes.
Director Lowenthal?
Yes.
Chair Richard?
Yes. Okay, item three has been presented. And so now it's time for board discussion and board action. And so let me just start by asking my colleagues if there are questions or comments that they'd like to make on this item that we heard this morning. Director Curtin.
I know we're, I'm going to keep it brief. I'm very excited about the idea of the locally generated alternative. I think it is a good sign that things are happening. I did want to ask...
Pull your mic a little closer.
I did want to ask a question regarding the water issues that were not actually pertinent to this alignment, but in general in the San Joaquin Valley, because of the critical issues regarding groundwater and the critical nature of the industry with agriculture here. Are we working carefully with the water districts to make sure that as we develop further water issues that are going in the South San Joaquin area, that we will have our train capable of enhancing the ability to bring water into the South San Joaquin Valley for groundwater, in other words, overpasses and that sort of thing. I just want to make sure, I brought it up once before, but I wanted to put it on the record that we're attentively looking at being a part of that process.
Ms. Gomez, you want to address that?
So the irrigation districts are part of our stakeholder list. So we meet with every single irrigation district, and in some cases, we do have agreements in place with them when we do impact their facilities. And then in some cases now where we do have the design builders, they have been meeting with the irrigation districts to be able to assist in possibly creating some recharge basins. So they are part of our process.
Thank you.
Ms. Lowenthal.
Thank you. First of all, I do want to thank the authority staff for working on this and improving, it appears to be a big improvement in the alignment to be studied, because this isn't final. I do have a couple of concerns. One of them is from the woman who said that there were 10 farmers on the alignment that weren't contacted. What's that about?
So what we do is we have met with most of the farmers along the alignment from Shafter. So we are looking also how the current approved alignment is through the city of Shafter, how we leave Shafter, and then how we get onto Burbank. So we have met with quite a bit of those farmers, and we'll go back and look through the list to see if any of them that we've missed. In some cases, we've been talking to them about undercrossings through their facilities. They've been actively between Shafter and 99, looking at how many undercrossings we would have through there, but we will go back and ensure that we captured every single farmer along the alignment.
Thank you. The other concern I have, well, first of all, let me go back and say, I think the city of Bakersfield has also done a wonderful job coordinating with the authority and working together to find this other option, and I certainly appreciate that work, too. I was concerned, though, looking at the map, with all that red that showed the new proposed alignment would be going through many communities who live close to the poverty line, is what it appears like.
And that would be part of the continuing studies as we're progressing. And so we, in partnering with the city, we have met with quite a bit of those communities, but we'll continue to do that, reach out to them, and see what forms of mitigation need to be included in our environmental document. So we'll continue to do that as we continue with the draft document, the development of the draft document.
Thank you.
Thank you. And just on Director Lowenthal's point, of course, it was Holly King who raised the issue, Ms. Gomez, of the 10 farmers. So we all know Ms. King. I'm sure she would have that list pretty readily available. So.
Yes, and we talked, and so we'll be meeting with her and asking her for that list.
Thank you. Other things, Vice Chair Richards, did you have?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of or three things summarizing. One, I am concerned about the impacts and implications of this alternative with regards to Shafter, and I encourage Jeff and staff to continue your work with Shafter to see how these impacts are, in fact, encompassing that community, and what, if anything, that we can do to be of assistance. With regards to the environmental justice comments that we've had, I think we all know it goes without saying that that's a major part of what will be studied, as I understand it, Diana, during the environmental work that'll be done after this meeting. I would only encourage, and I'm sure it will be, because we'll be looking very carefully at in-depth environmental justice studies, and we're very interested in what we are able to do to help mitigate the implications and impacts of what we're doing. And it especially concerns me, while I'm very pleased, as every place we've been able to impact a community in a positive way, where we have been able to work with local interests, but the encouraging thing of the LGA is the support that Mr. Tandy indicated in his presentation that the city of Bakersfield has for this LGA alternative. It's somewhat concerning when I listen to Councilmember Maxwell, who actually represents the areas where the stations would be located. So I would only encourage you also, Jeff and staff, to take into consideration carefully what Councilmember Maxwell said in your evaluation with regards to environmental justice. But beyond these things, we unfortunately recognize that we can't make everyone happy, and we can't turn the clock back in a number of ways that we may like to for other opportunities. But I think that we've got to continue moving forward, and when this vote comes, I certainly am going to support this alternative.
Ms. Schenck, did you have questions or comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, most of my questions were answered during the very good staff briefing that we got, so thank you, Diana and Tom, for that. I echo the comments of my colleagues with respect to the environmental justice issues. As you know, those are very, very important to me, I think, to the board as a whole. Could you just expand, Diana, a little bit on the question that I had during the briefing on the relationship with the Union Pacific, because, you know, we have a history with the railroads, and I just would like to have on the record where we are now with them.
Early on in the process, when the locally generated alignment was first in draft form, we met with the UPRR, our staff, and presented them with the proposed alignment to get their concerns. The other thing that we've done is we've pushed ourselves far enough away to ensure that required distance that the UPRR is asking, currently we are able to do that. And so we made, if you look at the LGA as it is today, it was a lot closer to the UPRR. But as we continued to work with the city and addressing the UPRR's concerns, we moved it further away from them to ensure that we are within our agreements that we've already agreed to and up north.
Thank you.
Director Schenck had asked earlier for some additional language that just clarifies for the public that this process does not foreclose a full analysis. Let me just ask Mr. Fellenz, were you able to come up with anything, or as a lawyer, were you without words?
Yeah, always have words. Yes, we will put in some whereas clauses. There'll be actually, I think, several of them, because I think there is some element of clarification that's needed to define what the word preferred means. In the federal environmental process, it's used before the final decision, and then confusingly, It is part of the final decision. So we will add several clauses, and I wanted to consult with the environmental lawyers to make sure it's extremely accurate as to several whereases leading up to and defining, as Board Member Schenck has asked, the word prefer in the context of this environmental process, making reference to the MAP 21 law that's in the federal law.
So then in order to be, I'm sorry. So how do we proceed? So I was going to say, would it be appropriate then if today's, why don't we do it this way? Because I don't want to vote on a document that we don't see. I think that is problematic. So let me make this suggestion for consideration. It may not be the right way to do it. That basically our motion today, if the board so chooses to adopt it, would include a provision that, as an attachment to the resolution, we will ask the staff to provide for the public further clarification of the definition of these terms as they're used in federal law, so that the meaning of them can be fully understood. Something along those lines, because otherwise I think we're left with either not voting today or voting on something that we can't vote on because we haven't read. So, but do you have a better suggestion?
One other different way that you could do it is we could vote on what's here before the board with a direction from the board to supplement this resolution at the next board meeting to include some additional language to define, with the board's approval, reading and approval, this definition of the word preferred.
We could do that. Any other ideas that members have?
I'm just a little bit concerned, and maybe it's nothing to be concerned about, but I'm a little concerned about when we see that definition, is it going to cause anybody to change their mind with regards to how they would have voted today?
Yeah, that's the problem.
And
we're here in Bakersfield today where we're affecting this community. I don't want to move this discussion to Sacramento where people don't have access, as ready access to the meeting, if we can find a way to do this.
Good. I think one thing to clarify, I don't think there is disagreement within the board about what the words mean. It's about providing the clarity for the public and for the record, I believe. Could I suggest that we take 10 minutes and try to come up with a clause that the board could agree on?
Sure.
Yeah.
We'll do that.
I think that's better. Before we do that, let me just, I just wanted to add a couple of comments and then we'll come back to this. I'm sorry? You wanted to give him time to do it. Okay. Well, then I'll hold my comments till later. All right. So we're going to ask Mr. Falenz to, and I would say less is more here,
yes.
I think, is the problem, that I understand the need to make sure that the environmental lawyers don't think that we're stepping into something. But I think the purpose here is to, as Mr. Morales put it, to clarify for the public what this means. And particularly, Mr. Bush, in his public comments, said that this word preferred was causing some consternation. So it's a term of art, it's a legal term, but we also live in a world of public perception. And so I think we're trying to find a way to do this in a way that complies with guidance we're receiving from federal agencies on the one hand, and on the other hand, not indicating an undue prejudice for communities that are going to be looking at this process over the next year or more. Ms. Shank?
Yeah, I think referencing the federal language is probably a good way to go to point that out.
Or maybe it's just stating it in the negative, that the term preferred alternative does not foreclose the board's full consideration of all the environmental impacts of this and other alternatives. Something like that, that I think may be the best we can do. You like that? Yeah. Yeah. So we'll ask Mr. Falenz to, we'll move into the lightning round of this particular item. Okay, so we'll set this aside for just a few moments and then move on to the next item in the agenda, which is the environmental and engineering services contract for the Altamont. City of Wasco. Consideration of approving the mitigation agreement for the City of Wasco.
Mr. Chair, just in introducing this quickly, we heard, I think, very eloquently from the mayor of Wasco about this, and this is one, and in light of the environmental justice discussions, I think this is a great example of what we can do through this program, and this is an opportunity not just to mitigate, but to actually improve an existing situation. And I think all of us at the staff level are very proud of this, having, seen, as was described, mothers pushing baby carriages across multiple tracks to get into town, and that this can be corrected by this action is something that we're very pleased to present to the board and pleased to have been able to work out with the city. So I don't think we need to have a lot of discussion, but maybe Diana, if you can just go through it quickly, where we can
questions?
Ask if you want.
Okay, it's been moved by Director Lowenthal.
Second.
I have some language here.
For this item or for the last item?
Sorry, for the last one.
I appreciate your level of concentration, but we're in the middle of item four.
Welcome back.
Okay.
Turn off the mic.
All right. It was moved by Director Lowenthal, and I think I heard a second. Okay, seconded by Vice Chair Richards. I also want to congratulate the staff on this and thank the City of Wasco. I think this is one of the reasons we do this kind of work.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to do the same thing. I know that we don't need to talk about it along, but This is just one of the great things, and while this may not be remembered over the course of time as people look back on what we did or didn't do, but this is one of the really important things that we have been able to do. And there is nothing, I mean, those of us, and I think probably most on the board and probably many of you out there have seen the housing, at least from the street, that these people are living in. To be able to tap into the programs that are being contemplated here with regards to the low-income tax credit, a federal program administered through the state, without a grant like this, the funding would likely be completely impossible. So to be able to develop this project, relocate it in a place that is a humane, meaningful, nice place for people to live, and live in housing conditions that probably are three or four times what these people have been living in, is really a great thing we're doing here. And Jeff, I really applaud you and the staff and whoever else worked with the city of Wasco to come up with this alternative, because this is really amazingly great.
It's beautifully said. So with that, would the secretary please call the roll? Thank you, Tom.
Director Schenck?
Yes.
Vice Chair Richards?
Yes.
Director Curtin?
Yes.
Director Lowenthal?
Yes.
Chair Richard?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Falenz, do you have anything for us? Are you in the middle of work? 1 minute. See, promises.
Jeff,
okay.
Jeff is playing attorney over there. Don't do that.
Yeah, this is not so good. All right, so why don't we, while we're doing this, consider extending the environmental and engineering services contract for the Altamont corridor. This is time only, no additional cost?
Correct.
Okay. We've read the write-up. Do people have questions about this? Time only extension? We are on five. It's a time only extension of this contract for environmental and engineering services in the Altamont corridor. Can I have a motion on this? Okay, moved by Vice Chair Richards.
Second.
I'm sorry.
Director Curtin.
Oh, as Director Curtin moved it, it was seconded by Director Schenck. Will the secretary please call the roll?
Director Schenck?
Yes.
Vice Chair Richards?
Yes.
Director Curtin?
Yes.
Director Lowenthal?
Yes.
Chair Richard?
Yes. Mr. Falenz?
Yes, I have this additional whereas clause for your consideration.
All right.
Whereas the selection of the preliminary preferred alternative is not a final decision and allows for full consideration of impacts, including those brought up by public comment and participation.
Say that last part.
Okay. Sure. Whereas the selection of the preliminary preferred alternative is not a final decision by this board and allows for full participation of the impacts.
I think
pardon
you
me?
Want the word consideration in there.
Yeah, full consideration of impacts, including those included in the public comment and participation, period.
Well, that last thing is kind of open-ended, is the public comment and participation. I guess not to wordsmith it, but to wordsmith it, I just say, in consideration of the full impacts. Well, I think what I was trying to say, the full impacts of, I'm trying not to open the door here. Help me out, counsel. I know, you're a corporate lawyer. That's the wrong time to. I just don't like the last couple of words. I think we're close.
Okay.
Why don't we just say, in consideration of the full impacts of. I was trying to get to the full impacts of, you know, the various alternatives presented. So in other words, just we're speaking English here for a moment. Okay, we have an alternative that we are telling the public at this point that even though we're going forward pursuant to CEQA and NEPA, that there is an alternative alignment that we think is preferred at this point based on what we know. And that becomes the baseline, it becomes the benchmark. Now,
it doesn't mean that if somebody comes up and says, wait a minute, we want to present evidence that another alternative ultimately will be better, that that information is going to be foreclosed. It doesn't mean that if somebody wants to challenge the assumptions that led us to say that this is the preferred alternative, that they can't do that. That's what I'm trying to get to. But at the same, by the same token, we're being fair with the public, which I suspect is the reason for the guidelines, and saying we do think at this point, based on the screening we've done, that there is a preferred alignment. You need to know that, but we will continue and complete this process in a comprehensive way. That's, I think, the idea that we're trying to capture here, not to back off from this as being the preferred alignment, but to also say it doesn't slam the door.
And Mr. Chairman, I think what we're saying is, with the information that's been collected to this point, available in, to staff, that their staff is recommending this as a preliminary preferred alignment, subject to the continuation of the environmental study process and any other things that may come into play between now and the time that it comes back to this board for final action, which includes not only the study of this, but the study of everything else we've been studying, correct, including even the hybrid alternative. Okay.
Okay. And I think it's important just to point out that the change in this process through the federal guidance is really intended to bring the public engagement in earlier in the process. Because what used to happen before was the preferred alignment was not identified until after the draft document, right, after the comment period. And so what the identification of the preliminary preferred is doing is saying, as the chair said, based on the information available at this time, based on the analysis that has been done to date, this is our preliminarily preferred option, and giving the public the opportunity to engage fully in the consideration.
Well, and not to draft by committee, but to draft by committee. To add the word, as defined by federal guidance. That's the part that I want to have in there, so that it is, because it is a term of art, it is, there are legal definitions here. So the PPA is as defined by federal guidance. And then I think,
well, how about just something like the term preliminary preferred alignment as defined by federal guidance, okay, does not foreclose comprehensive examination of all environmental impacts, something like that.
Okay. I have something here. Whereas, as defined by federal guidance, the selection of the preliminary preferred alternative at this time is not a final decision by this board, and allows for full consideration of all the impacts of the alternatives considered in the environmental process.
That's good. Okay. I think it's close enough.
Okay.
The board will now move on to picking the upholstery colors for the first high-speed rail train.
Mauve.
Okay. So it's moved and seconded, and I just want to make one quick comment. I'm sorry, for the record, it was moved by Director Lowenthal. Who seconded it?
Curtin.
Director Curtin. I just want to make this one, two comments. First, speaking personally, I'm very excited and pleased that we're doing this work in the city of Bakersfield. Bakersfield's going to be not only a midpoint in the system, but a linchpin of the system. And I can assure you that while there was some commentary from our business plan about where the currently funded alignment may end temporarily, we are not at all satisfied with that. We're bringing high-speed rail to Bakersfield. We are going to bring it to Bakersfield. We are going to work very hard to get the funding. We are going to get the funding. We're going to connect to Bakersfield. We're going to connect Bakersfield to the Silicon Valley and to San Francisco. It's vital to do that, and we're not going to lose sight of that. And so because of that, I think it is important at this time to be moving forward with the environmental process, so that as we come into the city of Bakersfield, we do it in the best way possible with the least impacts. So that's the first thing that I want to say. As we sit here in this community, we are coming here. We are going to connect you to the Bay Area and ultimately to Los Angeles, Anaheim, because it's vital that we do that, and vital for the state and for this community. And second, I want to say that I'm not expert enough in the local issues to know at this time, nor should I know at this time, because all the information has not been presented to me or my colleagues, what the ultimate best decisions will be. That remains to be seen with the evidence that's presented to us. But I think it is fair and proper, when you look at the title of this, to say that we have a preference for a locally generated alignment. I mean, think about those words. A locally generated alignment. That means the people of this community, by and large, have come together and said, this is where we think you should be looking. Well, I think it's important for us to do that. Having said that, I just want to end by saying this about environmental justice. It may sound pretty easy for people sitting up here to say, well, we care about environmental justice, and I guess I'll go so far as to say it may be easy for people who look like I do to say we care about environmental justice, but I want to talk to you a little bit about the things that we have done. My colleague Tom Richards eloquently and beautifully talked about the meaning of the activity in Wasco, what that's going to mean for people's lives. What it means, basically, is we did not relegate people to live on the wrong side of the tracks. I was just down in Southern California where we told the community in San Fernando that we were not going to take an alignment through most of Santa Clarita, through the town of San Fernando, the community of Pacoima, where many of the people in Pacoima lived because their parents had been displaced by the construction of Interstate 10 through East LA, and now they were looking at a new displacement. And we said, primarily for environmental justice reasons, we're not going to do this. And so we have basically addressed those issues there in Wasco, and there's a flip side to environmental justice too. Environmental justice doesn't just mean not running over people who are economically dispossessed. It also means standing up to the people in Atherton, one of the wealthiest communities in the state, and saying, I'm sorry that you don't want the train here, but this is where the route needs to go. And not allowing them to push us off onto poorer communities because it's just inconvenient for them. So our record will speak for itself. But I think that what you've heard from the entirety of this board is that as we come into this community, we will do it with the greatest sensitivity that we can bring to the considerations, and not just assume that because people have lower socioeconomic status, less economic power, less political power, that somehow that's where the train should go. We want to find the best route for the train. We want to do it in the best way. And this is just something that is very important to me, because at the end of this, we want to look back and show people that you can build a major infrastructure project like this, community by community, and do it in the right way. So that is our commitment going forward. I think staff has heard very clearly from the board that we applaud your work. We thank the city of Bakersfield for its leadership in this. We still have some work to do. We want to make sure that nobody gets stepped on, nobody gets left behind, and we'll continue to work hard on that. So with that, would the secretary please call the roll?
Can I clarify for the written record that this is for agenda item number 3?
It's for item number 3 as amended with the brilliant language of Mr. Falenz or whoever else wrote it.
Director Schenck?
Yes.
Vice Chair Richards?
Yes.
Director Curtin?
Yes.
Director Lowenthal?
Yes.
Chair Richard?
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, the staff. Thank you, Mr. Tandy, and your staff. Okay, we have one last action item, and that's the consider extending the legal services contract with Nossaman, time only.
Yes, Mr. Chairman,
of time,
board members, and Jeff.
Any
questions? I was going to take this opportunity to tell you a little bit more about the legal services and the advancements of the legal services since I last spoke to you about them. We have seven, including myself, staff attorneys now in the various subject matters. That's been extremely helpful in terms of gaining institutional knowledge in the legal arena for the authority, and also a great value. We have a really great staff, some really competent lawyers.
Hold on, Tom. If I could just ask people to take their conversations outside at this point. Go ahead.
Some very competent lawyers we have on board now, and I'm really pleased to have moved so much to bring some of those resources in-house and creating that institutional knowledge. But there are some circumstances where we cannot service the client with the resources we have in-house, and so we've gone out. And the two highest priorities is we go to the Attorney General's office to see if we can get the legal resources there because of the expertise that they have and also the value again. We also go to Caltrans for all our eminent domain legal services for right-of-way acquisition. And that's worked out very well so far. Finally, we do have outside legal resources that we use when the state attorneys don't have the capacity or the expertise to provide those legal services to the authority, and we have a number of firms under contract. One of the contracts that's been in place since 2009 is the Nossaman Law Firm contract, and it's been amended a number of times. And they have provided services mainly in the area of design-build contracts and environmental permitting. And the last time I came to the board was in 2014. I believe I asked for another additional $2 million toward the Nossaman contract, and we've only spent $1 million of those funds to date. And what I'm asking the board is for permission to your approval to extend the contract up to two additional years. We have about $1 million left within the budget of that contract, and there's some remaining things to be accomplished with the resources that Nossaman's provided. One is the train set procurement they've been quite involved in, and in fact, we've a couple times gone out with requests for proposals on the train sets, and we need to now go out again. One was jointly with Amtrak, and we heard back from industry that that wasn't going to work because they couldn't provide train sets that would be compatible for our needs as well as Amtrak's. And then a second time we went out with an RFP, but we decided to hold off until a later time. So in the next 18 months or so, we anticipate we'll go out with a train set procurement, and we would like to retain the Nossaman Law Firm to complete that task. We also have some environmental permitting that they've provided expertise on, and they have a lot of institutional knowledge that's going to be very helpful to retain them for the up to two-year period to help us complete the environmental process, which we hope to finish by the end of 2017. So with that, I ask that you allow us to extend the contract for time only with the remaining budget.
Does this include real-time legislative drafting, or no? That's just
yes.
That's low blood sugar joke.
Yes, okay. Mr. Chairman.
Director Schenck.
Thank you. So this is not a new issue. I first I want to commend you on the balance that you have achieved on in-house Caltrans, Attorney General, and outside counsel. We've come a long way. But as I said in 2014, when we we're talking about this contract, and again, I have the highest regard for that firm. Well, they've represented the state in many different capacities where I had the opportunity to work with their lawyers, and they're really outstanding. But as I said in 2014, going forward, I really want us to be creative and sharpen the pencil with outside counsel, not just the Nossaman firm. This, I know that we're asking just for extension of time today, and I have no problem with that. But we are going to be facing more legal issues as we go forward. And now is the time to look at what firms are doing in terms of the way they deal with the state or with any big entity. And, you know, as I said to you privately and publicly, we really need to be very cognizant of new ways of being charged. So. But with that, I'll move the motion to extend the time.
Thank you, Director Schenck. Moved by Director Schenck, seconded by Vice Chair Richards. And Secretary, please call the roll.
Director Schenck?
Yes.
Vice Chair Richards?
Yes.
Director Curtin?
Yes.
Director Lowenthal?
Yes.
Chair Richard?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fellenz. Mr. Morales, what would you like to do with the report on the status of...
I know. You have to let me speak. I'm already standing. No, well, I guess we could bring it to the next board meeting. It's informational.
I do think it's worth...
Yeah, I think...
We are building this project.
Yeah, so there's one report. Okay. Ms. Gomez, what did you want to tell us about this?
Okay, what I wanted to do was provide a quick update on the construction activities that are happening here in the Central Valley. So we have a couple of videos. So we do have construction approximately 119 miles, Madera to north of Bakersfield. And we have approximately $3 billion worth of contracts that have been executed. So a significant amount being currently spent in the Central Valley. So we have the three construction packages, and the first one, 32 miles, second one is 65 miles, and then the construction package four, which is 22 miles. We do have the six active sites. The first one is the one that's been furthest along, the Fresno River Viaduct in Madera County. Then in downtown Fresno, the city, in the downtown area, the Tuolumne Street Bridge demolition and construction. We also have started the one trench that we do have in the Fresno area. And then the Cedar Viaduct, which is a long structure that will go over State Route 99 as it leaves the city of Fresno. The other significant structure on the project is the San Joaquin Viaduct, which crosses the river, but as it's crossing, the San Joaquin River also crosses over the UP. And then our sister agency, State Route 99, who we have a contract with, which is relocating, shifting over a 2-mile section of State Route 99, and it is about 100 feet. So now we do have a video that shows some of the activity happening on all of these segments. With music.
Good morning, we're here at the downtown Fresno Viaduct and just showing some status of what we have going on here, what the contractor has already constructed. So down below, approximately 80 feet is the pile. There is concrete there. So now the next pour will come up and that'll be the column. Contractor right now is getting ready to start setting up the forms for the columns and for the flares. The structure that goes over 99 is a signature structure. So you're gonna see a fancier type of bridge there. It's gonna be an arch shape. The viaduct is gonna be coming straight this way, over 99, and then behind us in a straight line out north to the building that you see in the background with the two S's. We've continued now with the remaining four columns closer to the Union Pacific right away. We'll finish that up, and once the girders come up, then we'll be able to start doing the structure, the superstructure. So it's gonna be a bridge that will have traffic two ways. Stanislaus eventually gets demolished. Once the bridge is built, then they can open up the traffic as well, but it's also going to depend on when we demolish Stanislaus. We are here at the Fresno Trench. We are in between the Y's, and what that is, it's a side tracks that the Union Pacific Railroad owns, and we are building the trench in between the Y. We've already done the lagging piles. The next operation is to do the secant piles. You will see a trench here that'll be about 40 feet deep that eventually will go down below State Route 180, which you see up ahead of me. And then everything in between will get excavated out. This will be material that we use for our bridges and other locations. This is Dry Creek, which is not dry right now, but there is a canal going through there, and and we got to go under that canal, and we also got to go under the Union Pacific track that you see ahead there, the Y, and then go under State Route 180. Okay, we are here at another location that is under construction for the high-speed rail, and with me here is Mike Weber, the construction senior.
Let me just give you a brief update on the project to date. The new on-ramp for southbound 99 here at McKinley has been widened and upgraded. So the bridge widening has been completed. We still have some barrier to go up on top of the bridge deck. These walls, they're finishing up, and then they'll start on the adjacent dirt work down below, finishing up the barrier. So we were here in February. We had just poured the footing of this wall. So this wall now has been completed, with the exception of there's a barrier rail that goes up on top. So Ashland Avenue, we're currently in stage one of reconstructing the southbound off-ramp. We still have a retaining wall to construct on the west side of that stage one work. Once that's complete, we'll begin the stage two, which is ultimately the left side, or the left going southward.
We're here at the San Joaquin River Viaduct location. Immediately to my right, to the east here, is the Union Pacific Railroad track. You are looking right now at the alignment, and where that orange fence is up ahead, that's actually where we're going over Union Pacific.
Is this where the pergola is gonna go?
This is the pergola. So a pergola is a structure that is offset from alignment, because down below you still gotta get the train. Union Pacific has to run with a certain opening, and we're running up on top of them. So we have to build a structure that allows us to run on skew. This is the entrance as people come in on the north side, as people coming into Fresno. So that also has the arch structure. The contractor currently is working on tying the rebar cages together. Those are the rebar cages for the piles. Let's go straight to the top then. So now they put the formwork and the steel for what will be the slab of our structure, superstructure, where the train will actually be running. And as we look south, just to the south of where that crane is the abutment, and it's the final end of this viaduct here. We still have a piece in the middle here that we have to build, and that's the piece that goes over State Route 145. Once we get all of this done, we'll continue north. The forms, they are manufactured specially for these projects, and it's a variable parabolic design. If you see the one that's cast here right in front of us, it just kind of flares out, and then the front is actually flat. Yeah. And so the variable parabolic is what you'll see throughout the state, not only on CP1, but throughout the state. Everything else is pretty much set, and like you see here, we're just building the superstructure.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I do want to mention.
Point out on the last structure that was seen yesterday. In fact, we poured the first deck section. So, and today and tomorrow you'll see will be the next pouring. So, full blown structures where you can actually see what this will look like.
And we will continue to work with the team to update the website as we continue to progress with construction. As you saw in the video, State Route 99, a significant amount of work being done there. They are currently working through the final large package that would then continue moving 99 over. I do want to just mention some upcoming work sites. Actually, we were at Cottonwood Creek Bridge just yesterday. So things are happening rather quickly. And so we were out there yesterday. So they have the rebar cages. They had moved in that crane earlier in the afternoon as they prepare to start building that bridge that goes over a dry Cottonwood Creek. Avenue 8 and Avenue 7, these are all in Madera County. At Avenue 12, we have two overpasses, one that goes over us and the existing BNSF. American Avenue, which is one of the last structures in construction package one. And then Herndon Canal Bridge, which is another structure that goes over a canal. And then Shaw Avenue, where we're going, what we need to do there is there's a significant amount of utilities that need to be relocated. We're going to reconfigure some city streets. So when we do start building the Shaw Avenue overcross, Shaw Avenue will still remain open. So a lot of activity that will continue to move, advance very, very quickly.
And yes. Everything that we saw in the video, and by the way, nice.
Is real.
Nice, yeah. Well, yeah. let us know if you start doing CGI videos, okay? but that was all construction package one, right?
That is correct.
Yeah, okay. So we're not even seeing the two, three, and four. That's good.
Yeah, and so you could see here for construction package 2-3, we have advanced the right-of-way acquisition significantly. We have about a six-mile continuous area that we're asking the contractor to start moving into. Utility relocation has already started. Geotech work has underway. Demolition has already commenced as well. So we have quite a bit of properties on CP23, so we've started to do some of the demolition and grubbing. And we are getting very close to start reconfiguration of some of the Tulare County roadways, which are expected to start any day now.
Very good.
Construction package four, as you remember, the board approved it in January. And this contractor, California Rail Builders, is moving very, very quickly. They have already identified a site in the city of Wasco. They've been working with the city to get the permits in place, so they would be moving in trailers, and that would be where our job site would be. They've started to already advance the design. We've also had two kickoff meetings with the local agencies, including the city of Shafter was present, city of Wasco, and Kern County. So they are moving rather quickly in identifying some of their subcontractors and specifically some of the small businesses. So we're pretty excited on how quickly they are ramping up. And tomorrow we have a big meeting in Wasco that where we'll be meeting with Sunny Gem, which is one of the big employers in Wasco, to figure out how we can minimize those impacts. So quite a bit happening also on CP4. I do want to talk a little bit about the small business participation. So our design builders have been very, very active in reaching out to small businesses. As you can see, the numbers there on CP1 and CP23. I also, construction package 4, design builder will be here on Friday, meeting with, here in the city of Bakersfield, meeting with small businesses as well. And you heard earlier about the partnership with Griffith Construction, which is from the city of Bakersfield. So we do have a video that showcases one of the small businesses.
Well, my grandfather started in the concrete business in 1947. My father was in the industry and retired in 2000. Concrete is in my blood. I'm passionate about concrete.
With a long family history in the industry, it was only fitting that Curtis Lovett would one day own his own concrete business.
And having my own business was something that I always wanted to do.
It was also fitting the outdoors lover would buy Outback Materials, a company based in the foothills of the Sierra since 1968.
I mean, we're a mountain company.
But nearly as quickly as Lovett was able to expand his new business into the valley, the recession hit.
60% of our revenue dropped over 15 months. So we had to be responsive to the market conditions. We had to lay some people off. We had to shelve our plans to move to Fresno, which was one of our strategies at the time.
Those plans would have stayed on the shelf Had Outback Materials not been awarded a contract to supply the concrete for construction package one of the high-speed rail program.
Clearly, it's allowed us to make an investment here in Fresno to build a new concrete plant, a state-of-the-art plant, buy 15 new ready-mix trucks and a loader. So we've had to hire upwards of, it'll be 25 employees by the time we're done.
Levitt's locally owned concrete business beat out several multinational concrete companies for the contract.
Clearly, without the small business percentage required, I would have not been offered an opportunity to do the job.
That aggressive 30% small business participation goal has put 266 small businesses to work on the project. And Curtis says he sees the benefit of high-speed rail to his company and his community long after the project has been completed.
So I see the Central Valley becoming almost a bedroom community of the South Bay Area and Silicon Valley. Having population growth to the Central Valley because of the high-speed rail route will provide big demand for concrete and construction products in the local area.
Here are some of the, as you saw from the videos, the individuals working out on the project, and these are, as part of our community-based program, we have to track the hours. And so as you can see, that's the hours that we have been tracking. Also, the pre-apprentice training programs that are being held in the, you heard earlier about the, here in the city of Bakersfield, but there is several of them throughout the Central Valley. Just a couple of faces from high-speed rail. Giovanni Moreno, he joined students taking the pre-apprentice training class at the local hall. He had a felony in the past and was having a hard time finding a job, but because of our national target hiring initiative, he was able to join a pre-apprentice class and began working as a pre-apprentice on CP1, digging and setting up forms for laying concrete and moving beams. He is currently doing traffic control for Associated Traffic Safety. It's a women-owned disadvantaged business enterprise that has a contract on construction package number one. Christian Cachadorian is the project manager for the Fresno-based DVBE, owned by her father, Catch Environmental, which many of the board members have met. They have been contracted to do hazard abatement and demolition on the high-speed rail project. Her day starts at 6:30, delivering generators, water trailers, and other material to the job site. Catch Environmental is now contracted both on CP1 and construction package 2-3. Tammy Prado spent her first 20 years, her first professional 20 years as a bookkeeper. When her daughter Savannah was born, she needed to find a career that could provide a better future for her family. In 2002, she was entered into the union and is now working on the first construction site for high-speed rail in the Central Valley. Born in Madera and raised in Madera, she describes her current work on the Fresno River Viaduct as the perfect job. Tammy is one of the 8 carpenters working on the Fresno River Viaduct. She is the only woman at this construction site. Becky.
We need to tell the Carpenters Union to do a little better with their gender equality. Do we know anybody from the Carpenters Union?
The last one is Becky Zacharek. She didn't know what she wanted to do for a career. She just knew she loved the outdoors, big trucks, and dirt. Eventually, she decided to put herself through truck driving school in Fresno. That's where she met Curtis Lovett, owner of Outback Materials. Becky told him, "One day I will be driving a truck for your company." 10 years later, Becky is a driver for Outback Material. So those are some of the faces and stories of the high-speed rail construction job sites in the Central Valley. So that concludes my presentation.
Yeah.
Yes, there will be.
You know, the words that came into my head were, that's an antidote for all the political baloney that we deal with all the time on this program. So Thank you, Ms. Gomez.
Thank you.
You made us happy that we stayed around for that. We didn't shunt you off to some meeting in wherever next time. So,
thank you,
Diana. That's great work. That's really great. Much as I know my colleagues would love to stick around, I think we've run through the agenda. It's been moved to adjourn. It's seconded by everybody. And thank you again to the City of Bakersfield for allowing us to use these chambers. Thank you all.